Hi, friends. Joe Hafner here. I'll have the latest episode of First Cup for you in just a few seconds, but I want to take this time to remind you of a few things, like you can send me an email with your comments, suggestions, ideas, likes, and dislikes about this show, things you'd like to hear, things you don't want to hear, or Song of the Day request. Send those emails to GunthersHouseOfFriends@gmail.com. That's GunthersHouseOfFriends@gmail.com. Or leave me a message on my Skype account and look up this user address. It's letter G, G800-486-8437. That's G800-486-8437. An easy way to remember that is to get out your old landline phone and look up the letter G. You don't have to worry about that. But spell out 800, G800, and then spell out Gunther. It's G800 Gunther. Okay, so G800-486-8437 is what that turns out to be. Follow me on Twitter, personally, at jhafner99. That's where you see more of my private thoughts. Or follow the network by looking up this Twitter address. Okay, you ready? Look up Gunther's Friends on Twitter. That's where you get all the latest happenings in regards to the Gunther's House of Friends Network. And friend me on Facebook by going to facebook.com/Gunther's House. Or click on the hot link on my website at tinyurl.com/Gunther's House. That's good on your PC, Mac, Linux, or tablet computer. Or on your smartphone at tinyurl.com/Gunther Mobile. That's good on your Android, iOS, Windows Phone, or as well as on your tablet computer. And you can also listen to previous episodes of this show, as well as previous episodes of Joe's Retro Radio, by downloading the Stitcher app, which is available via hot link on the opening page of my website, or going to Stitcher.com, as well as on Spreaker.com, at Spreaker.com, Be Heard, and look up Gunther's House of Friends there. On Miro at GetMiro.com, that's M-I-R-O, as well as on iTunes, and on the Windows Media Store. And now, without further delay, it's time for today's show.
What is the charge? Eating a meal? A succulent Chinese meal?
Hi, friends, and good morning. Have you heard about this? Of course you've heard about this. You know, that seems that personal information on nearly 40 million Target customers was stolen a few weeks ago by hackers. You know, Target customers are still outraged, and NSA officials are really impressed. Good morning, my friends. Today is Saturday, January 4th, 2014, and you know what that means. It's time for your first cup.
I got a feeling that it's gonna be a wonderful day. The sun in the sky has a smile on his face, and he's shining a salute to the American race. Oh boy, it's swell to say,
good morning, USA.
Just like that, we start the program. Yeah, I played the short intro this morning because we have a lot to take care of. Good morning. It is the fourth day of January 2014. Good Saturday morning to you and yours. And welcome to a weekend edition of First Cup as we do our best to stay warm on this bitterly cold morning. And it's about to get a whole lot colder. I have details on the weather forecast coming up in a few minutes, along with the latest in news. Doing things a little bit differently. I've decided to bring you news from the BBC, of all places. Yeah, we're going to have that a little bit later on, as well as some sports information. The return of Highly Questionable has arrived, and they did a show yesterday, and I'm going to bring it for you today. That's coming up a little bit later on. Also have the CBS News Weekend Review. And that's coming up in just a few minutes as well. Pardon me, I drank some orange juice a little bit ago. And the funny thing is, yesterday when I got off work, I bought some orange juice. And for some stupid reason, I think it's because I was dead tired, I put it in the freezer instead of in the refrigerator. Now keep in mind, this is the carton. I'm not talking about the little concentrated can. I got it in a carton. A little plastic carton, and I put it in the freezer, and I didn't realize it until I got home from work early this morning when I pulled it out, and I had orange slushies, so I'm waiting for this thing to thaw, and some of it did thaw. Thankfully, it didn't freeze all the way through, but it's still like pulling out a 5-pound brick, and thawing a little bit, and I have an orange slushie this morning, so what a way to start off a Saturday. Well, it's my sad duty to tell you, friends, if you haven't heard yet, overnight we learned that Phil Everly of the Everly Brothers, the older brother of, or rather, who with his older brother, Don, made up the country rock and roll duo the Everly Brothers, died yesterday in Burbank, California, due to complications from chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, or COPD, and Phil was just 74 years old, but so a little bit later on, we're going to have a tribute to Phil Everly of the Everly Brothers and playing some of his music. And for those of you that don't know or are too young to remember, like me, but of course, I grew up listening to the Everly Brothers along with a bunch of other oldies groups and artists because my dad was of that era and instilled to me a love of music of the 50s and 60s. My mom picked up in the 60s and 70s and did other fill-in-the-blanks and that type of thing. But anyway, the Everly Brothers' influence on popular music in the 50s and 60s was immense, to say the least. The songs they strummed and sang and legendary harmonies were often big hits. During the height of their powers, they had almost 36 hits on the Billboard Hot 100 singles chart. 36 hits. And included tunes like Wake Up Little Susie and Bye Bye Love. The Everly Brothers were among the first 10 acts inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. The duo influenced some of the best artists of the 20th century, such as the Beatles and the Byrds. And according to Bob Dylan, quote, "We owe the Everly Brothers everything. They started it all," unquote. And so my condolences go out to Phil Everly's family as they go through this difficult time, because I'm sure that it is a very difficult time. Lifetime of smoking sure didn't help Phil in the long run. You know, it may have deepened his voice to a certain extent. You know, that's a trick a lot of old broadcasters used to do. And a lot of musicians, of course, are known to smoke too. But we'll save that debate for another time. But as I said, I'll have music from Phil Everly a little bit later on during the song of the day. Okay? Some programming changes. And I know I've been promising you some stuff, and I've changed things at the last minute, and I apologize for that. But between my work schedule and trying to get caught up on sleep, I am going to focus my energies primarily on this morning's show. There's the possibility that I may be doing away with Joe's Retro Radio, or maybe just do it once in a while. I don't know yet. But I will continue to do this morning's show at all cost. It may be a little late getting posted sometimes, but I will continue to do this morning show because this is my pride and joy. This is my autobiography, And you're getting a glimpse into my thought processes in my life, okay? You're free to disagree with me, but as long as we disagree respectfully, you know, we can still be friends, okay? So with that being said, tomorrow is going to be the debut of my new religion program, The Devil's Advocate. I'm going to incorporate that segment into the Sunday morning version of First Cup, okay? That'll be its own segment in addition to whatever else is on my mind, okay? And then the Wednesday program, the Legislative Affairs program, that's going to be incorporated into the Wednesday program of First Cup. That's where I'm leaning at this point. I would still like to do Joe's Retro Radio, but chances are me doing that live may not be feasible for the time being, but we shall see. But that's what's going on with those programs. But First Cup will always get first priority here on the Gunther's House of Friends podcasting network. Okay. Now, some things in the news. First of all, let's see. Some weird items in the news that I wanted to bring up. And just give me a moment. First of all, in some news items, a breakup leads to charges against five people. Yeah. Prosecutors say a Springfield man, I assume this is Springfield, Missouri. I want to make sure, though. Where did this article come from? I should have paid more attention. Yeah, let's try this. Let's see what... put that in Gmail. Well, that doesn't help either. Okay. Well, anyway, I guess that's not really relevant. Maybe hopefully it'll say in the story, and I didn't bother to write it down when I archived that. That's my fault, and I apologize. Well, anyway, prosecutors say a Springfield man suffered a beating by six people hours after he ended a relationship with his girlfriend. Yeah, that's what I just read. I can't believe it either. Yeah, the young woman's friends allegedly said he should have handled the breakup better. Now, let me reemphasize that. Prosecutors say a Springfield man suffered a beating by six people hours after he ended a relationship with his girlfriend. Apparently, it was at around 3 a.m. when Darren Poole heard a group of people outside his Delaware Avenue apartment. Okay, so Springfield, Delaware. According to court documents. Looking through the peephole, Poole realized the group was made up of close friends of his ex, according to the court documents. Police say that 20-year-old Tyler Cartoyas, 19-year-old Montana Householder, 17-year-old Amber Wright, 23-year-old Amanda Lancaster, and 21-year-old Tara Cones, and another person, unidentified in court documents, began to try to force the front door open. Well, Poole, as well as two of his friends who were staying at his apartment that morning, tried to hold the front door shut, but were overpowered. The trio retreated to the bedroom, but the angry group was able to push through the second door. Poole say police and his two friends were assaulted by the group. Injuries were described as minor. Well, soon after the September 22nd incident, police interviewed Poole's ex-girlfriend, Erin Burt. Burt reportedly told or said that Cartoyas, Householder, Wright, Lancaster, and Cones went to Poole's apartment because, quote, they were angry with his handling of the end of their relationship, unquote. Police also interviewed Wright, who denied being involved in the assault. She did admit, though, according to police, that she posted on the internet a picture of her injured knuckles and commented that she had been in a fight. Investigators say other suspects failed to show for scheduled interviews. On last Friday, the five were charged with first-degree burglary, assault, and property damage. The maximum sentence, if convicted, could exceed 15 years in prison, though that sentence is unlikely. Prosecutors noted none of the defendants have prior felony convictions. Bad breakup or not, that's none of your business. And you just don't go around beating people up. What was the point of that? Other than to express your outrage. I don't know what those people were thinking. Well, they weren't thinking. They were just reacting. But I just thought that story was so off the wall that I had to pass it along to you. Some other news. A woman accidentally gets a gift intended for the Obama family friend. For an Obama family friend. Yeah. This has been in the news the last few days, but I wanted to put it in here for posterity's sake, okay? Apparently, even the post office makes mistakes with mail from the White House. On New Year's Eve, pardon me, I'm trying to adjust myself in my seat, and this chair is not very comfortable. Apparently on New Year's Eve, an Illinois woman received a package her brother-in-law had sent to her family for Christmas. Now, the damaged box came with a surprise. A gift from Barack, Michelle, plus the girls, according to the handwriting on the self-adhesive gift tag. Elaine Eklund Church said her husband opened the box at breakfast on New Year's Day and found it in major disarray. The gifts were broken open. Parts of the old box were in this toilet paper box that the post office had repackaged, and in the bottom of the box was this extra gift. Church told the Today anchors on Thursday via Skype. We were reading the tag, trying to figure out where this came from. It was opened, so we then discovered this was a very personal gift to Mama K. Now, that would be Eleanor Mama K. Wilson, a close friend of the Obama family and godmother to Sasha and Malia. And the gift was a personalized book of photographs. Private moments of the year of 2013 together, Church said. Well, after learning about who the gift's intended recipient was, Church tracked Wilson down and phoned her. That's when she learned the Obama daughters make their grandmother, or rather their godmother, a memory book every year. Well, that's a neat gift. What better way to give a gift than to... I like that. Well... Church wrote on her Facebook page where several friends initially questioned whether anything from the White House would be delivered with such unceremonious wrapping. Church assured the Today anchors that the gift was legitimate and would soon be making its way to the Wilson, to Ms. Wilson and her family. She declined to show any of the photographs inside her book. Well, I can't believe the Today Show would be that tacky. But then, they are reporters. Sometimes reporters make stupid mistakes. I'm not saying this is the right thing. But that is someone's private mail, and it should not be publicized like that. Now, I have no problem with them publicizing the fact that the post office screwed up and delivered this package to the wrong house. But you just don't go around posting other pictures, other people's pictures, especially on a national program like that. So, I don't know. But, nevertheless, an interesting story. About the U.S. Postal Service and answering that question, do they ever deliver the wrong mail from the White House? And the answer is most definitely yes. Well, speaking of the president, before I get on with what else is on my mind, I'll have his weekly radio address for you in just a moment, okay? Some other news today. This is a bizarre article that I came across a little bit ago. Seems that a study published this week in the journal Frontiers in Zoology suggests that dogs choose to relieve themselves along a north-south axis in line with Earth's magnetic field. Now, I've walked a lot of dogs in my time, but I don't think I've ever noticed that or paid attention to it. I was just more relieved that the dogs relieve themselves outside than worrying about what direction they were in relation to Earth's magnetic field. Now, the motherboard blog reported on the study's findings, saying that the research was carried out by a team of Czech and German scientists. Okay. We have wished to study how dogs poop. Siegfried, bring in the poop. Bring in the pooch. Well, apparently, dogs are sensitive to small variations of the Earth's magnetic field, the research team said. Dogs prefer to excrete with the body being aligned along the north-south axis rather than the east-west axis. Okay. The study examined the habits of 70 dogs during 1,893 defecations. Oh my god. Ooh. And 5,582 urinations over the course of 2 years. Consistently, during times of calm electromagnetic weather, the dogs chose to eliminate while facing north or south. Dogs aren't the only animals, apparently, that are sensitive to the Earth's magnetic fields. When it comes time for them to mate, salmon use their sense of the Earth's magnetism to find their way back to the spawning grounds where they were born. Birds similarly migrate along magnetic lines. Even ants have been proven to have a sense of the Earth's alignment and to distinguish between north, south, east, and west. As to why the dogs prefer to poop facing north or south rather than east or west still remains a mystery. Didn't they think to ask a dog? I mean, you had 70 dogs there to talk to. Why not ask one of them? I'm sure they would tell you. I can't help if you don't speak their language. It's still it's still a mystery as to why dogs do align at all, whether they do it consciously or whether it's the magnetic field is perceived by their senses or sight, hear, smelling, smell, the compass direction, or perceive it as a haptic stimulus, or whether its reception is controlled on the vegetative level. They feel better or more comfortable or worse, less comfortable in a certain direction, wrote researchers. Our analysis of the raw data, not shown here, indicates that dogs not only prefer north-south direction, but at the same time they also avoid east-west direction. So all those times I was walking a dog, whether it be Gunther, Hilly, Fritz, Shu, well, I really didn't have to walk Shu much. He took care of himself. Or Klaus. They were trying to go north and south all the time. That would explain some of their erratic behavior. Now, the dogs did not exhibit the preference, however, when they were being walked on leashes. It was only when they were left to their own devices, that they expressed the preference. Still, I don't know. I'm going to have to watch dogs, but the problem is I live in town, so dogs aren't permitted generally to be free from a leash unless they're out in a yard. But I don't know. That is interesting. I never really paid much attention. But apparently somebody did, otherwise they wouldn't have gone to the trouble of saying, we ought to research why dogs only take a number two when they're pointing north or south. That would be some interesting data, don't you think there, Siegfried? I went from talking about idiots and global warming yesterday to dog poop. Yeah, this show is heading down the crapper, to say the least. Of course, it was a week ago today, there was a crapper incident at the Walmart, or not the Walmart, but the library. But we won't get into that right now. Well, that's what's on my mind at the moment. Yeah, not a whole lot there to talk about, because we have a lot to take care of on this particular episode of First Cup. Let's see. Make sure I don't have anything else here. Nope. Have the weather forecast coming up in just a few minutes, as well as the latest news from the BBC. And what else? Composer's Datebook, Writer's Almanac, plus a whole lot more. Have Highly Questionable around the corner. But coming up next, after Things You Need to Know, Things That Are Trending, President of the United States and his weekly radio address. So stick around, my friends, as I stall for time and load the appropriate PSAs and so forth and whatnot. And to remind you that, I'm in Studio 20 this morning. I'm Joe Hafner, and this is your First Cup.
your parents.
Much of what we learn in this world
comes directly from you.
Whatever your message is, it will become part of us forever.
Please teach us to accept one another. Teach us to respect one another.
Please, do not fill our minds with hatred.
Do not expose us to bigotry.
Do not teach us to judge each other
by race,
religion,
orientation,
or the color of our skin.
Teach us the concept of tolerance.
Teach us to understand one another.
Teach us to accept people
of different cultures
and persons with different beliefs than yours.
Please help us to create a world
where every man, woman, and child is treated equally.
Dear parents,
please don't teach us words of hate. We learn from you every moment. If you use a certain word,
which might be hurtful to others,
we will repeat that word. Please don't show us acts of hate.
If you act against people of different faiths,
we will repeat your actions.
Dear parents, we are your children.
And we are relying on you
to help us create a world where every person is tolerant of one another.
Artu, where are you? Artu? Artu? Artu, you're on fire! R2-D2, you found a cigarette. Well, I don't think smoking is grown up at all. Because it's very dangerous. Smoking does dreadful things to your lungs and is very bad for your heart. Well, I know I don't have one, but humans do, and I think we should set a good example. Well done, R2. Oh, hello. You know smoking is bad for your health, and it isn't grown up at all. So please, don't smoke. R2, do you really think I don't have a heart?
Hi, everybody, and Happy New Year. This is a time when we look ahead to all the possibilities and opportunities of the year to come, when we resolve to better ourselves and to better our relationships with one another. And today I want to talk about one place that Washington should start, a place where we can make a real and powerful difference in the lives of many of our fellow Americans right now. Just a few days after Christmas, more than 1 million of our fellow Americans lost a vital economic lifeline, the temporary insurance that helps folks make ends meet while they look for a job. Republicans in Congress went home for the holidays and let that lifeline expire. And for many of their constituents who are unemployed through no fault of their own, that decision will leave them with no income at all. We make this promise to one another because it makes a difference to a mother who needs help feeding her kids while she's looking for work. It makes a difference to a father who needs help paying the rent while learning the skills to get a new and better job. And denying families that security is just plain cruel. We're a better country than that. We don't abandon our fellow Americans when times get tough. We keep the faith with them until they start that new job. What's more, it actually slows down the economy for all of us. If folks can't pay their bills or buy the basics like food and clothes, local businesses take a hit and hire fewer workers. That's why the Independent Congressional Budget Office says that unless Congress restores this insurance, we'll feel a drag on our economic growth this year. And after our businesses created more than 2 million new jobs last year, that's a self-inflicted wound we don't need. So when Congress comes back to work this week, their first order of business should be making this right. Right now, a bipartisan group in Congress is working on a 3-month extension of unemployment insurance. And if they pass it, I will sign it. For decades, Republicans and Democrats put partisanship and ideology aside to offer some security for job seekers, even when the unemployment rate was lower than it is today. Instead of punishing families who can least afford it, Republicans should make it their New Year's resolution to do the right thing and restore this vital economic security for their constituents right now. After all, our focus as a country this year shouldn't be shrinking our economy, but growing it. Not narrowing opportunity, but expanding it. Not fewer jobs, but doing everything we can to help our businesses create more of the good jobs that a growing middle class requires. That's my New Year's resolution, to do everything I can every single day to help make 2014 a year in which more of our citizens can earn their own piece of the American dream. After 5 years of working and sacrificing to recover and rebuild from crisis, we have it within our power right now to move this country forward. It's entirely up to us, and I'm optimistic for the year that lies ahead. Thanks, and have a great weekend.
From Studio 20, I'm Joe Hafner, and this is Not Today on NBC. Rather, it's First Cup on the Guthers House of Friends podcasting network. And what do you say we take a look at lottery numbers? I forgot to do those a little bit ago, so we'll take care of that right now. And taking a look at lottery numbers, first of all, in the Mega Millions drawing from last night, apparently there was one lucky winner from the state of Tennessee, and picks up $32.3 million after taxes. Jackpot was worth $61 million, and last night's numbers were 22, 24, 25, 40, 70, and the Mega Ball number was 5 with the Mega Plier number 5, okay? 22, 24, 25, 40, 70, and Mega Ball number 5 with the Mega Plier number 5. Powerball numbers for tonight, worth an estimated $60 million before taxes, $33.2 million. Won't read you those numbers. Did that on Thursday's show. And take a look at Missouri Lottery numbers, Missouri Lotto numbers, that is. And the numbers for, well, that won't be drawn until tonight, will it? Never mind. I'm getting a little ahead of myself there. Okay, what do you say we take a look at the Show Me Cash numbers for yesterday, okay? Those numbers yesterday were 2, 9, 10, 11, and 35. Again, yesterday's Show Me Cash numbers were 2, 9, 10, 11, 35. Incidentally, those numbers were worth $77,000. Pick four midday numbers yesterday. Those numbers were 5, 2, 2, 9. 5, 2, 2, 9. That's not right. Those are my picks for today. The numbers for yesterday were 3, 4, 1, 0. 3, 4, 1, 0. Were the numbers for yesterday. Pick four midday. Pick four evening numbers for yesterday were 8151. 8151. And the pick three midday numbers for yesterday, 473. 473. Pick three evening numbers for yesterday were 866. 866. And those are your winning lottery numbers for today. Congratulations if you're a winner. If you're still a loser like me, you'll be just saying stuff like this.
I never once said Nagada.
Okay. And with that being said, it's time for Highly Questionable on this edition of First Cup.
Welcome to Highly Questionable. I'm Dan Levitard. This is my father. Happy that Nick Saban lost, not happy that the Heat lost last night. That Aquaman over there is Bomani Jones. What we got today?
So did Chris Cluey get fired for taking a controversial stance, or did he just get fired?
Is that indeed Aqua? I'm not sure. Vamos, papi.
Did Bob Stoops prove last night that the SEC is overrated?
This is a bittersweet feeling for Bob Stoops because he gets the feeling of victory and he gets the feeling of being right because he said the SEC was overrated and it is overrated. But the bittersweet part of this is the way he gets to be right is your conference is not that good. If one of the best teams in it loses, to Bob Stoops in a big game.
Yeah, but let's be clear about something here. Stoops basically said that not everyone in the SEC is Alabama. Stop acting like the lower tier schools in the SEC are as good as the top. And he was right about that one. What we saw yesterday, Alabama isn't quite the Alabama. We don't think about it because it's a nameless, faceless machine. So faceless that we made A.J. McCarron, who should be really nameless and faceless, into the face of this team, right? The pass rush, not so good. The secondary, as you saw, really not that good. And you know that because this Oklahoma team had a lot less talent than Alabama did. You could see it, and it was pretty clear. But Bob Stoops outcoached Nick Saban in a way that we didn't think Bob Stoops could do anymore.
Alabama didn't merely lose to a freshman quarterback last night. They lost to a freshman quarterback who was 11 for 28 for 80 yards against Louisiana Monroe.
Hey, Tricky Nicky, I got news for you. You don't finish, Caput. I enjoyed that game immensely until the very end when you had that guy, McCarron, you know, did that 45 seconds. That was the best part of the game. You thought that you were driven in. Well, guess what? You had no chance, buddy. Your boy got buried down there.
Say this, though. Everybody who says Alabama didn't care, Alabama had no motivation, did you see how mad that little man was? Somebody cared about this game.
Should the NFL change the rule that forces the Niners to play in Lambeau this weekend?
Well, this always happens when we wind up with a situation where a wild card team has a better record than the team they're going to play. Happened a couple years ago with 7-9. Seattle hosted a playoff game and then ultimately beat the Saints. Here's the thing. This league is set up so that teams in these divisions basically play the same exact schedule. You only get 16 games in the NFL. And if you're going to break this down, and if you're going to make division rivalries what they are to sell the league, you've got to say that if you win your 16-game slate, where 14 of them are the same as these other four teams, you get to play a home game. That's just how it works.
I'd like to see the rule change, but in this particular case, while it feels unfair to have a 12-4 team traveling to an 8-7-1 team, Green Bay doesn't want to be playing in Green Bay either this week, and they don't want to be playing in negative 13-degree temperatures. In fact, I've talked to Jordy Nelson about this, Greg Jennings when he was with the Packers. They want a dome on Lambeau Field. Nobody wants to play in conditions worse than the Ice Bowl, but the 49ers are better equipped with their style of play to play in conditions like the Ice Bowl.
So Fidel Godel is trying to take care of Aaron Rodgers, eh? I got news for you. Collins is coming at you. There is no way he's going to lose that game. It doesn't matter where San Francisco play, they're going to win.
That's right. Collins Kaepernick is coming to get you.
Would you rather back Chip Kelly or Sean Payton?
Yeah, we got a pretty interesting game in Philadelphia this weekend, right? Two of these funny-style, newfangled offenses that don't really seem like they're the best schemes to run in the freezing cold. Two teams you think would prefer to be on a fast track, but you take Chip Kelly and this isn't complex. Here's why. He runs the ball, and as much as that might look fancy because of how they do it, this isn't real complex. This is basic NFL football, inside zone running. That's what you think they'll probably need in the conditions that they've got. Sean Payton, a little bit too impressed with his own intelligence, likes to do all kinds of stuff that does not involve running the ball, and that's not a good idea in the cold.
He's got much more conviction about this than I do. I have no idea what to make of Philadelphia, going 6-0 in a really bad division. They won all their games against horrific defenses, but the Saints have never won a road playoff game. He was talking before about that 7-9 Seattle team. The Saints went to that 7-9 Seattle team, and they lost to that 7-9 Seattle team with many of these same players.
Oh, look, I know the Eagles aren't that good. You know who else I know isn't really that good? Nick Foles, and he looks like a video game character this year, and the reason he does is because of the dude in the headset.
And the division.
If the Chiefs beat the Colts this weekend, will you finally see them as a real contender?
No is the short answer to this question. I wish we'd stop asking this question. I was getting it all season. The Chiefs against playoff teams, against teams that are in the playoffs. 1-5 this year. I will not believe in this team, not if they win. I will have my belief reaffirmed when and if they lose.
Yeah, we get real Sam I am when we get to talking about the Chiefs, right? I'm sure it's not very attractive to people in the central part of this country. I will say this, though. I don't think they're a contender. I don't think they're going to win a championship. But do you think that either team that has a first-round bye really wants to play a team with all that talent they have on defense? Do you think that Denver really wants to have to see them again with Peyton Manning's arm in cold weather? Do you think the Patriots, who won a whole lot of games, and we don't really know how, really want to have to face up with that defense in a one-game playoff? I'm telling you, they're not contenders, But people don't want to see you.
That sounded like fear. I don't know. You're taking both sides of this.
No,
they're not contenders.
No.
But you just made me terrify
right.
them.
No, they're not going to win three or four games, but they might win one or two.
I'm now scared of the Chiefs, and I wasn't before he started talking.
Do you think Chris Cluey was really released because of his outspoken support of same-sex marriage?
He ended his career yesterday by going to Deadspin and calling his former coaches cowards and bigots. But the reason he was replaced is not for his opinions. Any number of players in that league are valuable enough to express those opinions and be outspoken. The reason he was replaced is because he's replaceable. And if you could get anybody to do that job, you're going to get the guy who doesn't talk a lot.
Yeah, we had Cluey on Dan's radio show yesterday, and I asked him, why is he not punting right now? And he said, basically, at his age and what the veteran's minimum would be, somebody could get him for cheaper, and then we don't entertain that possibility at all as it relates to why he's not playing with the Vikings. If the owner of the team is on the same ideological side as Chris Cluey is, as he stated in that Deadspin story, it's hard to believe he would have gotten jettisoned for that. But you know what might have gotten him cut? The Ray Guy patch that he wore that game advocating for the former punter to make the Hall of Fame. Not that there's anything wrong with that necessarily, but that kind of looks like you're just looking for causes, and the NFL is not really looking for dudes who's looking for causes.
The P word here that's important is not politics. It's punter.
Was it smart for the Bears to sign Jay Cutler to a 7-year extension?
Well, is it the 7-year extension that we're talking about, or the $18 million a year for the first 3 years? Are we discussing the sense of the 7? It'll probably never get to that. We know how these contracts work. And no, this was not smart. Now, don't get me wrong. The Bears didn't have a whole lot of options. This is the one position in the league where you can't say, oh, we'll get somebody else and figure it out later. You've got to have a quarterback. But at what point are teams going to stop tying up such a significant part of their salary cap in quarterbacks that might not be among the 10 best in the league? That's what Baltimore did. That's what Chicago's doing right now. Even though we've seen teams year after year win Super Bowls with good quarterbacks on cheap contracts. You need a quarterback, but you also need them cheap. This ain't cheap.
Well, when you say it's not smart, though, the problem with that is if you don't have any other options, this is what you're faced with. There are so many new coaches right now coming into the league, and all the coaches who are no longer in the league that just got fired because they didn't have quarterbacks. All the new guys, if this becomes available, will be willing to pay this guy this and would be willing to tie themselves to Jay Cutler. I don't know whether it's smart or not, but you have zero choice here. You have to re-sign him.
You know why I like Jay? He just doesn't throw a touchdown to his own team. He throws it to the other team.
Yeah, never a dull moment there with Jay Cutler. The over. Always bet the over on Jay Cutler.
Why would you like that?
It's different. Coming up next on my son's TV show, I ask more fascinating questions.
They're not that fascinating.
This question is about where you're going to put your money, right? Ring! Ring! Juanito, listen, it's Papi. It is Friday, and I am in the mood to ask more questions.
Which means we couldn't get a guest.
Which quarterback would you put your playoff money on, Phil Rivers or Andy Dalton?
If I was wagering money on these kinds of quarterbacks, I would no longer have money to wager on quarterbacks. Phillip Rivers is the better quarterback here, but Andy Dalton's got the better team.
Yeah, the Bengals are going to win, but let's be clear. If you're asking me to bet on a quarterback, Phillip Rivers is just in another class from Andy Dalton. We're still confused as to whether or not Andy Dalton is actually good. If the Chargers win, chances are it's going to be because they have Phillip Rivers and the Bengals have Andy Dalton, who up to this point, you know, hadn't won one of these things, and he's tried a couple times.
Do you realize how absurd it is that he's absolutely right? Not that part, that he's absolutely right. We have no idea if Andy Dalton is good.
This question is about where you're going to put your money, right? Ring! Ring! Juanito, listen, it's Papi. Yeah, big game, yeah. Listen, it's Phil Rivers against Andy Dalton. You know, put everything that I got on the Phil Rivers. What? The guy's going to... What do you mean? Well, you know, I gotta back up a guy that has 7 kids. Don't worry about anything else, you know? I mean, he's a winner. He has been very busy on and off the field, so I gotta go with him. Okay, put everything on Rivers. Take care, buddy. See you. Oh, by the way, how's Dan's girlfriend? Is she hanging on? Good? Okay, send my regard to her.
Hanging on.
Take care,
Hang
buddy.
Up the banana.
I Hang love up. You. Happy New Year.
Hang up the banana.
What you think she hanging on to?
You shut up.
Just asking.
Does it seem like April Justin is proud of her son?
April Justin's kind of becoming a recruiting tradition at this point. 2 years ago, her son Landon Collins decided on television that he was going to go to Alabama and not LSU. And if you saw it, you can't forget it because it looked like this.
I can't believe this happened again.
Here, but I'm going to go with Roll Tide Roll.
Ooh.
Ooh, not
Alabama
very happy.
Alabama gets the number one safety in the country, Landon Collins. Now, might I ask you your reaction? And I'm only doing that because there was not a lot of joy here. Can I ask why?
I feel this LSU is a better place for him to be. LSU Tigers, number one. Go Tigers.
Now, look, to be fair, I think that we do a disservice to these ladies quite often. You just hear your son is moving away. That hits people kind of hard. But then it happened again this year with her son, Gerald Willis III.
I can't believe this happened again.
LSU or Florida for Gerald Willis III. Where will you play your college ball?
I would take my time at the Gainesville, Florida. Florida Gators.
Gerald Willis III. Your take on this decision, ma'am?
It is what it is. Florida Gators, that's where we're being.
Any easier this time?
Yeah, but LSU's still number one.
And there you have it. Gerald Willis III going to the University of Florida.
We should be laughing because it's funny, but I am made sad by this. Did you notice that neither one of those tough young men would make eye contact, any eye contact, with their mother while they were talking? There was zero eye contact. That was very cold, all of it.
Look, all I'm saying is this. If LSU has the mother on their side and they couldn't bring either one of them in, I got some questions about the recruiting in this situation. All these recruiters always say, get the mom, it's all good. Y'all got her. Y'all got her like nobody else has got her, and you can't get none of her sons. What in the hell is going on?
I believe we are celebrating and laughing at total family dysfunction here.
Hey, Les, you got to change your recruiting book. You got to do something. You know, you're doing is attracting the mothers. You got to attract the players, buddy. The players, they're the ones that are going to make it or break it. Not the mothers, not the ladies.
Right. Yeah, remember this, though. Sometimes you go to a school. Sometimes you go away from one. Which one do you think is going on right here?
What did you learn about A.J. McCarron last night?
Yeah, A.J. McCarron, we kind of dressed it up in the broadcast as if this was going to be his coronation, kind of like Tim Tebow in his final Sugar Bowl. Didn't go that well, didn't play that well, and then after the game, McCarron stood up for it.
You put it all on me. I had two turnovers, ended up scoring 14 points, and we lost by 14. So I'll definitely take the loss and definitely take the blame because a lot of it's probably my fault.
It's not just a one-man team, man. We all win together. We lose together, man. AJ can put that all on himself. I can't let him do that.
I mean, that's a pretty special level of maturity you see in a moment like that, because it's not like Alabama didn't care about that game. They cared and they lost. But what I thought was most interesting about that whole thing, we don't see a lot of humanity from Alabama football. We don't think about the guys being there. You see how quickly Kevin Norwood jumped up and showed a sense of camaraderie that we don't think about. Maybe this isn't just a football factory, and maybe these are actually young men who care a little bit about each other and the things that happen that we never consider, because all we really talk about is Nick Saban.
It was an interesting reaction from him, because most of us in our workplaces, if we have a profound failure, the human nature is an accountability. It's not a mirror. It's who else was to blame for my failure? He took it all. He shouldn't take all of it, but I don't think we learned anything about him either, other than he's robo quarterback. That's what a robo quarterback needs to do.
He should have blamed the coach.
Yeah, well, there you go.
Let's be clear. Chicky Dicky did get his arse handed to him in that game.
And there was someone after that game not talking like A.J. McCarron. Nick Saban, you don't hear that from him, ever.
Coming up next on my Son Stevie show.
There's no way to effectively do this. There are no red lights. Okay.
Oh! Time to play the game that doesn't trust Bill O'Brien Chin. Do you question?
Got a little thing in it. Anyway, you give us topics and events, we question them.
Do you question who won this fight?
Man, I just want to see a fight. I haven't seen a good fight in a while. You ready to see a fight?
I don't know if this is a good one or not. Let's see it.
Let's go. Ooh, boys from another country. They fight for real over there.
Why is there a man running in the road? What's happening here? What just happened? Oh, wow. Screeching tires. He's in a rush to catch up to that other guy. And this guy with the camera is now in a rush because he wants to film this. Oh, no. What's going to happen here? Yeah,
wow, we got there just in time.
What's happening here? Whoa. Well, he hadn't calculated for that. You got to wait for the other person to get out of the car.
So one guy is clearly more enthusiastic about this fight than the other.
This is excellent commitment by our cameraman, by the way.
This is so far fast road rage.
This guy didn't learn from the first time that he's got to wait until the other person gets out of the car. Is he going to do this a third time?
There's no way to effectively do this. There are no red lights. Okay.
Oh! Now we got a winner.
You going to go get him or what?
No, is this... He's got a knife?
Whoa.
The other guy's not leaving this side of the car. He's staying right there.
Yeah.
The doors are locked.
Yeah. Oh, no. Yeah. No, you don't. Oh, no. Now he's in.
Is there a broom involved?
Look.
No, they just shoved the tie.
Got a broom and everything.
Yo.
Get up and fight. Don't use your feet. Come on, get up and fight.
We can get up and fight and hit him with a shovel.
Against a knife. I know we're laughing at this. This has the potential to not be very funny at all.
It's going to be funny no matter what. If you got a shovel, you never let the man close enough to stab you. Whoa, that was a nice jab.
Oh, look at him. He's going Karate Kid. The Karate Kid Danielson now.
Come on. Sweep the leg. You got the shovel? Sweep the leg.
Throw snow in his face. Excellent with your shovel.
I don't know.
Where's the thing? The guy up top had a problem. The shovel completely changed the game because what's he going to do? Drive away? He just drove off the road. You're standing there with a knife and you can't get close enough to stab him. That must be really frustrating. You imagine wanting to stab somebody, but you just can't get close enough.
An underreported part of this fight, incidentally, is the idea that this guy would jump with his knife on top of the van for some reason. And you think that's a good strategy as he tumbles off the van.
At least he's cut himself.
I think that the guy with the knife was a big chicken. You know, he just kept showing the knife to the other guy, but he never approached the other guy.
In my general experience, a dude that's willing to cut you normally got some man in him. That's not a coward's play.
You got to get close with a knife.
Yeah.
A shovel, not so much.
Yeah, you got to have it in you.
What would you rather have in a fight, a shovel or a knife?
Oh, definitely a shovel, you know, because you got a longer reach and you got to keep, you can hit the guy on the head with the shovel one time, two times, three times. Keep hitting the guy on the head with the shovel until his head splits open.
Yeah.
Sounded like he had some experience with this.
Plus, after he's dead, you can use the shovel to bury him so the police won't be able to prove anything, you know?
Hey, he's got the whole crime mapped out. He's absolutely right. From start to finish, you split your head open, you kill him, and then you bury him in the desert.
I'm so afraid.
And then you walk away with a new knife.
Hey, why let a good knife go to waste?
Time to play the game that drinks to remember. See? Oh, no.
You tell us what to watch on TV tonight. We tell you if we're intrigued or not.
On ESPN, the Orange Bowl, Clemson and Ohio State.
I am interested because I think this is going to feel a little bit like that Central Florida-Baylor game. Those two teams are just going to run up and down the field. I want to watch it. Bomani, do you?
Oh, you got to be interested in this one. Look, it's Ohio State, which doesn't play any defense, against Clemson, which gave up 70 the last time they played in this game and is always at high risk of Clemsoning.
Poppy, are you intrigued?
Oh, see, I'm very intrigued, but this is a local game, right? I don't want to watch it on TV. I want to be there. I want to be with you two guys, tailgating and everything. You know, this is for all the marbles now, you know, in South Florida, you know, where the weather is 100% right, you know. I mean, it's about 75 degrees and everybody's about 10 below, you know. You gotta support the Orange Bowl, no?
No, and it's not for all the marbles. It's like for a marble and a half.
And it's cold. It's like 63.
Saturday night in Phoenix, Flyers and Coyotes.
No, not interested in this one, but am interested in showing you some video of Coyotes goalkeeper Mike Smith. Look at this. Minute left in overtime, tie game. Keep your eye, close eye on Mike Smith. Oh, it's in it. Oh, no. Mike, you're going to back in? Mike, that's a goal. Red light, noise, let's go. That's a goal. Mike's, oh, Mike. That is a goal. Of course it's a goal. Mike! Oh, Mike. Bomani, are you intrigued?
I am intrigued. And I'm wondering, can you get these guys tighter shirts? You wouldn't have had this problem if y'all had gave them a tighter shirt. Get a man a tighter shirt.
Poppy, are you intrigued?
See, I'm very intrigued, but I don't know what is the big deal. I get things stuck in my pants at all times. I score with things in my pants at all times.
Oh,
so I don't understand where they're criticizing
I
this guy, you know?
Score with things in my pants all
the
time.
Yeah, that's true.
No, it's not true. It hasn't been true for 40 years.
I got something in my... You want to see it?
No, I don't. See it? No.
If in doubt, you got to go to the source. Yeah,
no,
I got to convince you.
No, we do not.
You want me to convince you?
No, I want you to take your hand off my shoulder.
We believe you. We believe you.
Beginning Saturday afternoon, the NFL playoffs.
Yes, of course, we're interested in the playoffs. Super Bowl predictions, do we want to do that or is it too early? I think all of us would agree Seattle's the best team, but best team doesn't really make you the playoff winner. Who you got in the Super Bowl, Mo Money?
I tell you what does make you a playoff winner. Playing in that madhouse that they play in, the team that beat them there, isn't in the playoffs. Seattle out that one conference, Cincinnati out of the other. And yes, I just picked the Cincinnati Bengals to go to the Super Bowl.
I picked Denver with zero conviction. Poppy, are you intrigued?
Oh, see, I'm very intrigued because the last four teams that they have played, Philadelphia in the home openers, they have gone on to win the Super Bowl. And you know who is playing against Philadelphia this year? The Chargers. So I'm going with the Chargers.
What?
That's a hell of a statistics, huh?
No, it's a totally useless statistic.
You know that Phil Rivers have 7 kids?
Yeah, you mentioned that.
Well, that's it. He got my vote of confidence.
Right. Okay.
You know how hard he has to work to keep those mouths fit, you know?
Every time he goes home, it's a huddle. They're
that's
all looking at him, waiting on the play.
That's right.
Just about
that's right.
15 people.
So can you find another quarterback with 7 kids? Huh? Tell me. Oh, there you have it.
Trust me, he ain't the only dude in the NFL with 7 kids.
That's all the time we have for today. Thank you for watching.
Back on Monday. Have a good weekend.
Gracias. See you el lunes.
Hi, friends. Joe Hafner here. I'll be right back with more First Cup coming up in just a moment.
Log of the Starship Enterprise, stardate 5943.7.
Captain Kirk, this is Lieutenant Uhura. Mr. Spock is ready to patch in. Go ahead, Mr. Spock.
I'm on the surface of the destroyed barbarian planet now, Captain.
Destroyed? What do you see, Mr. Spock?
The surviving inhabitants are in a dreadful condition. It seems they can't control their limbs, and their minds are dull and useless. Fascinating. They seem to be in a state identical to that curious 20th century Earth disease called hard drug abuse. I suspect it has destroyed all meaningful life on this wretched planet.
A tragic find, Mr. Spock.
As a Vulcan, I find the need for hard drugs to be totally illogical.
But as a half-human Spock, surely you can appreciate the suffering that hard drug abuse causes. We can only hope that other civilizations will not make the same mistake.
Learn more now, earn more later. That's a motto CBS Radio wishes every college student would paste inside his or her wallet. A lot of those collegiate wallets are a good deal fatter than usual these days, thanks to summertime jobs. And as a result, quite a few young men and women are finding themselves tempted to forget about school this fall and keep on with that job. This isn't such a smart idea as it may seem. It's a plain and simple fact that dropouts from college are less likely to find and keep better-paying jobs. Quit school before you finished, and you're not only cutting down on your chances for a really good job, you're also throwing away thousands of dollars of possible future income. Finish college, get all the education possible, and your lifetime income is many thousands of dollars higher. America needs well-educated young men and women, and the rewards are sure. So if you're wavering now that school's about to open, don't decide against your future. Go back, and remember, learn more now, earn more later.
It takes 12 years to create a graduate. It takes about the same time to create a dropout. The difference between a child becoming one or the other could be you. Studies prove that reading to a child regularly dramatically improves reading skills. And kids who read well by third grade are 4 times as likely to graduate. So United Way is calling for 1 million volunteers over the next 3 years. We're asking you to step up, make a pledge, tutor a child who needs help, mentor a kid who needs someone on their side. Volunteer to read to children. Make a difference. because when a child advances, we all advance. Entire communities improve. The path to success or failure starts long before graduation day. And the difference between a graduate and a dropout could be you. Be a reader, tutor or mentor, give, advocate, volunteer, live united. Take the pledge. Go to liveunited.org now. Brought to you by United Way and the Ad Council.
This episode of First Cup is sponsored in part by Wishing Stars Native Creations, Marshall Woodworking, Fine Art Today with Maria Sewer, and Mary Kay Cosmetics with Jennifer Jacobs-Moorhead. Check out their websites and many more on the Friends page at tinyurl.com/Gunther's House or tinyurl.com/Gunther Mobile. Welcome back to Studio 20 on this Saturday morning, the fourth day of January 2014. And this is your First Cup with yours truly, Joe Hafner, here at the controls, rocking it out with Peter Gunn and Henry Mancini and company. Well, Henry wrote it, but I don't think he performed it, did he? Well, let's see what I have on the program still to come. Let's see, we took care of Highly Questionable. I'll have news from the BBC coming up in a little bit, and also have the composer's date book, The Writer's Almanac with Garrison Keillor, and All Things Considered in just a moment. Celebrity birthdays today in history. Let's see, I took care of lottery numbers, so we don't have to worry about that. I did forget, though, to tell you what's trending, so we'll take care of that right now. Well, after Peter Gunn, because it'd be a shame to just cut this theme off right here and just jump right into the next segment. Plus, I would much rather hear Peter Gunn, anything by Henry Mancini. Even him passing gas is better than hearing things like, "Why did the fox say?" Well, you're going to hear a snippet of that in a little bit anyway. Thing I noticed, though, the other day in the internet, well, I've noticed for several years, as a matter of fact, but it amazes me at how it has made the world smaller in some ways, in that the 6 degrees of separation, I think, are actually getting smaller and smaller, or more like 3 or 4 degrees. For example, the other day, I wished one of my favorite national talk show hosts, radio talk show host, a happy birthday. Now, his birthday is not till next week, I think on Monday. But anyway, his name is Jimbo Hannon, and I first started listening to him about 20 years ago when I started my job at Quicks and Kirk Radio. And for whatever reason, I never heard of him until I started working at Quicks. Well, when you're in college and so forth, getting out of high school, going into college, you don't have as much free time to really listen to a lot of things, even though I was a bit one of those geeks that liked to listen to radio. I was more into listening to music stations than I was into talk radio at that point. But I quickly developed a fondness for Jimbo Hannon and his stance, and even though he's more moderate to conservative compared to my point of view, I still admire what he does and what he has done for broadcasting. And just want to say, Jimbo, if by chance, if you happen to hear this podcast, again, happy birthday. But he sent a response back. Now, I'm sure it's more of a publicity thing because we don't know each other personally, but I did talk to him briefly, believe it or not, about 10 years ago. And I'll never forget that morning. And he sent me an autographed picture. I've got it somewhere in storage, I hope. But anyway, he called one morning when I was getting ready to do the 505 weather on Cress, 505 in the morning. And he called just right before I went on the air. And luckily, I was able to override the system and, you know, let it roll on. Well, anyway, I pick up the phone. It's on the 800 number. And the guy goes, "Well, it looks like I caught you under the wire," or something to that effect. I'm like, "Excuse me?" And then we had a little bit of small talk and said, "This is Jimbo Hannon, and I was trying to get a hold of Ken Cuiava." It was my boss at the time. And anyway, I guess he was going to do an interview with him on Quicks on the morning show. And so that really highlighted my day, you know, to talk to a guy who speaks to everyone in the country, has that potential, you know, Granted, there was a limited number of stations that listened to that broadcast Jimbo Hannon's program. But anyway, Jimbo, happy birthday once again. I don't know what I'm saying here. I'm just kind of babbling. The coffee is not quite kicking into my brain yet. So, but I think you understand that. When you've been on radio or broadcasting for as long as we have, you know, I've been doing this for almost, I've been broadcasting off and on for 21 years now. Wow, I still can't comprehend that. Because I started in, 1993. Yeah, I was in late 93 when I started. I just now realized that. And later this month will be my 20th anniversary of starting at Quicks and Crest Radio. But we'll save that for another day. Anyway, let's find out what's trending. I went on that little spiel just after coming out of Peter Gunn. Now, that's what really amazes me. Here's my
Why did I get your mass text? I'm in your contacts. Why did I get your mass text? I'm in your contacts.
And let's find out what's trending today. Not a whole lot to talk about, but today is Amnesty for Polygamous Day. Yeah, President Benjamin Harrison granted a pardon in 1893 for those charged with polygamy. This was done to help a group of elderly Mormons in Utah who had practiced polygamy their whole lives. Harrison specified that those pardoned must henceforth obey U.S. marriage laws or be prosecuted. Either way you go, they're going to be screwed anyway. That was a bad joke. I'm sorry. Today is also Trivia Day, and it is Pop Music Chart Day. And, that's all that's trending there. Incidentally, yesterday I told you in the preview about the Missouri Tigers participating in the Cotton Bowl, and they did all right. They beat Oklahoma State. Let's see, what was that final score? Let's see if I can find it real quick. I caught part of the game on while I was on break at work. Let's see if I can find the score. It's funny, I have a sports program on, but they didn't read the score. But, of course, that was produced before last night's game. Whoops. Come on now. I'm trying to get my Nook HD reader to log on to the internet. For some reason, I don't know if it's the latest update, but whenever I turn the screen off, it shuts off the internet too after a certain period of time. So then I have to reinitialize it. And I tell you, it's really annoying because there are a lot of other internet signals in the neighborhood. And frankly, it gets a bit annoying trying to find it. Of course, I could have looked this up ahead of time, but that would have been boring now, wouldn't it? Okay. Missouri Cotton Bowl. Whoops. Put a space after that. All right. If it brings up a cotton gin, I'm going to throw this thing across the room. Okay. Yeah. Missouri wins 41-31. It's a fairly quiet game, but nevertheless, the Missouri Tigers did win the Cotton Bowl on Friday night. All right. Let's see. I took care of trends, got the lottery numbers, took care of President Obama's weekly radio address. Normally, this is where I would do news headlines, but instead, I will just run the news because I don't have the news headlines for you. Frankly, there's no reason to stonewall this segment on a Saturday. I gotta get back to bed anyway because I gotta work tonight. You lucky bastards, though. You don't have to worry about that, do you? Or do you? Well, anyway. Let's see here. So we'll roll the news right now, and then when we come back, we'll have a look at that weather forecast, okay? So stick around, my friends. I'm Joe Hafner, and this is Your First Cup.
This is the BBC. For details of our complete range of programs, go to bbcworldservice.com/podcasts.
Welcome to the latest global news recorded at 14:30 hours GMT on Saturday, the 4th of January. I'm Valerie Sanderson with a selection of highlights from across BBC World Service News today. Coming up, Al-Qaeda's top commander in Lebanon, wanted for attacks in a number of countries, dies in detention. There's been more violence in Bangladesh on the eve of elections, which the opposition is boycotting.
Everybody in Bangladesh is feeling disenfranchised. We have called upon the people to reject the election.
As the South Sudan government plans an assault on opposition-held cities in the country, the two sides are still in Ethiopia for peace talks, but haven't yet met face-to-face.
That is very important, that we talk to each other in order to resolve this in a spirit of reconciliation and in a spirit that will help our people.
And we remember Phil Everly of the Everly Brothers, who's died at the age of 74.
We went to a dance on a Saturday night, and Bye Bye Love by the Everly Brothers came on. And it stopped us in our tracks.
But first, the Lebanese army has announced that the top al-Qaeda commander in Lebanon, Majed al-Majed, has died in detention. A Saudi national, he was the leader of the al-Qaeda-affiliated group, the Abdullah Azam Brigades, which said it carried out a number of deadly bombings that targeted mainly Shiite suburbs in recent weeks, including an attack on the Iranian embassy. Murad Batal al-Shishani from the BBC's Arabic service told me more about the man.
Actually, we are talking about the one of the most important and significant regional operatives of al-Qaeda. I'm saying regional because he was covering a wide range of borders from Lebanon, Syria, Iraq, and sometimes in Yemen. Majed al-Majed was the co-leader of the Abdullah Azam Brigades with another Saudi guy called Saleh al-Qarawi. Saleh al-Qarawi now was in a bad health condition, but he's detained by Saudi Arabia. Majed al-Majed, however, was involved in a couple of attacks and operations of al-Qaeda in a couple of places, Yemen and Lebanon. Today's his death would raise a couple of questions. His relation with Saudi Arabia, he was on the most wanted list, which published, released by Saudi Arabia authorities in 2008. His relation in Iran, because some reports say that he has been training in Iran. Also, the most importantly for Lebanon these days, the recent attacks, as you mentioned in your introduction. These attacks will be mysterious, so many people will ask these questions will keep unanswered until now, which will raise huge debate among Lebanese and also in the neighboring Syria, Iraq, as well as in Yemen.
So, an important man in al-Qaeda, how did he die? Do we know?
The report saying that a kidney failure, and this will raise also questions, wouldn't these Lebanese authorities was unable to provide him with treatment while he's in prison? This also will increase the mysterious behind this story, I believe. But the reports we have so far is that he has a kidney failure. Because he was arrested already in a hospital while he was searching for a treatment for these kidneys.
How will this affect, do you think, then al-Qaeda-affiliated groups in Lebanon?
I think it will be minimum. That's al-Qaeda, how they are successfully able to regenerate, if you like, leaders, because they are, you know, relying on sort of a couple of grievances which are still remaining in the area, especially with the issue with the unstable situation in Syria. This will give them a golden opportunity.
Murad Batal al-Shishani from the BBC's Arabic service. Meanwhile, in Syria, reports are emerging there that Islamic rebels have given their rivals from a group linked to al-Qaeda, known as ISIS, 24 hours to surrender. The ultimatum comes after days of infighting in two northern provinces. Our correspondent, Rami Rahim, is watching events for us in neighbouring Lebanon and told me more about the fighting.
Reports suggest that ISIS positions, and ISIS, of course, stands for the Islamic State in Iraq and Syria, are coming under attack in different parts of northern Syria, in Raqqa, in Aleppo, in Idlib. They are coming under attack from other also Islamist brigades. ISIS, of course, are seen by many as the most extreme of the Islamist fighting forces in Syria, those fighting against the Syrian government. And they stand alone as the only group which has decided to declare a state, an Islamic state, in the areas they control, both in Iraq as well as in Syria. Other groups, even those which say their ambition is to build an Islamic state eventually in Syria, have yet to announce that state. They say we are still in the jihad period, so we are not exactly at the stage where we can actually announce a state. That is only one bit of the differences between ISIS and other groups. They are also accused of being uncompromising, of rejecting clerical arbitration in issues that arise on the battlefield. They've also been accused just a few days ago of torturing to death a member of the Islamic Front, one of their leaders, a young doctor who controlled an area in northern Syria. So all of these things seem to have come to a head, and they're under attack from many different groups in northern Syria now.
And tell us more about the Islamic State of Iraq, this group. Who belongs to it? Is it Syrians or people outside?
Mostly people outside. It used to be the Islamic State in Iraq, and it was the Al-Qaeda affiliate in Iraq. And for years, even before the Americans pulled out of Iraq, this was known to be the main Al-Qaeda group in Iraq. When the Syrian revolution started, Al-Nusra Front was announced in Syria, and it was part of the, it was actually dispatched by the Islamic State in Iraq as another Al-Qaeda affiliate to fight in Syria. The two groups fell out, and Nusra Front now remains the official Al-Qaeda affiliate in Syria, while the Islamic State in Iraq has changed its name to the Islamic State in Iraq and Syria, ISIS, and now claims to be fighting both battles at the same time, which it is, because it is also under attack at the same time across the border in Iraq, under attack from Sunni tribes in Anbar, which is the extension, the geographical as well as the tribal extension of the Syrian desert. So this is really fusing into one story across Syria and Iraq in a way which we haven't seen before.
What does this mean for President Assad's government? Will they see it that the opposition are fighting among themselves, or will they be worried that something stronger will come out of this?
That's a very good point. On the face of it, it would appear that they would be very, very happy that the opposition is fighting amongst themselves. And they have cause to be, of course, because precious resources are being diverted from many very hot battlefields against the Syrian government. However, as you said, if there's any kind of decisive victory for one side or the other after all of this is settled, that means that the opposition fighters, especially the Islamist part of the opposition, will be in a much better position to concentrate on the battle it wants to concentrate on, which is the battle against the Syrian government.
Rami Rahayam. It's the day before the general election in Bangladesh, but those who say the vote will not be free and fair have stepped up their campaign to disrupt it. Dozens of polling stations have been torched as the opposition Bangladesh Nationalist Party, which is boycotting the election, leads a two-day national strike in protest at what it's calling a scandalous farce. At least 100 people have been killed so far in weeks of violence over these polls. Shamsher Chowdhury is a former Bangladeshi foreign secretary and vice chair of the BNP.
We have never condoned any form of violence. We have always been against all forms of violence. The people have rejected this election. Everybody in Bangladesh is feeling disenfranchised. We have called upon the people to reject the election through peaceful protest all over the country.
Bariul Alam Majumdar from the campaign group Citizens for Good Governance says voters are in a difficult situation.
What is going on, it may lead to a collective suicide for our nation. It may destroy our democratic system. So the common people are in a horns of dilemma. It's in danger, as a matter of fact. They are damned if they go to the polling booth. They are damned if they don't. So their personal safety and security will be endangered.
A correspondent, Mahfouz Sadiq, is in the Bangladeshi capital, Dhaka. He told me more about attacks on the polling stations.
It's very difficult to get the exact numbers on how many have been set alight because many of these polling stations are housed in schools and colleges in remote parts of Bangladesh. At this point, we know that at least 100 polling stations throughout the country in nearly 20 districts have been set on fire. And many of these schools were set fire upon overnight because there is a heavy security presence throughout the country. The army has been deployed. There are also reports of sporadic clashes between pro-government and opposition supporters. And till this point, we have received confirmation of at least one death. But we are still, the reports, the capital, Dhaka, has remained mainly quiet overall because, as I was saying, there's a heavy security presence also here in the capital.
Much of this protest is about the government refusing to hold these elections under a neutral caretaker administration, something that happened a great deal in the past. Why have they resisted this?
Well, the government of Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina insists that this is a constitutional necessity. They amended the constitution, as you were hearing, 2 years ago, removing that provision for a caretaker government under which several previous elections had been held. They cite a court ruling which declared this provision illegal and not clashing with the constitution. But it is the Awami League, governing Awami League, which had originally protested and brought about this system in 1996. So, I mean, at this point of time, it seems that the governing Awami League is determined to go ahead with these polls and with one-sided elections. Even governing Awami League leaders are admitting that this election might not hold for too long, and at some stage, very soon, they might have to hold another one.
Mahfouz Siddiq, reporting from Dhaka. The stuttering start to the peace talks in Ethiopia over South Sudan show no sign of gathering pace. At the time of this recording, direct negotiations hadn't started, though teams representing the president and the deputy he sacked are in Addis Ababa. Talks, when they take place, may take some time. Speaking to the BBC, the foreign minister of South Sudan, Barnaba Mariel Benjamin, says he's refusing to offer any significant concessions to the rebels.
Our side of the compromise is that we have accepted that there should be negotiation. That is very important, that we talk to each other in order to resolve this in the spirit of reconciliation and in the spirit that will help our people to stop the suffering and the fighting going on.
In South Sudan itself, forces loyal to President Salva Kiir are preparing for an assault on Bentiu and Bor, the two cities held by the supporters of his former deputy, Riek Machar. Our correspondent, Anne Soy, is following events in the South Sudanese capital, Juba, and Emmanuel Igunza is at the talks in Addis Ababa. First, Anne gave me an update of the situation on the ground.
Yesterday, there was a clash between the government forces, the SPLA, and the rebels. The SPLA reports that they captured an area called Pariang, which was in the hands of the rebels, and pushed back the rebels. But the rebels are still holding the town of Bor, and we understand there was fresh fighting today. The government has said that it is very keen to retake the town of Bor, which is in Jonglei State, just north of Juba.
Emmanuel, is the fighting on the ground, is that a reason for the talks not getting underway face-to-face?
The reason that has been given why there has been a delay in starting the talks is that both teams from President Salva Kiir's delegation and that of Riek Machar are still negotiating about the agenda of the talks. They want to know the nature of the talks. And one agenda only that has been agreed so far is about the cessation of violence. Even as the fighting continues in South Sudan, that issue here is becoming a big concern. Earlier on, I spoke to Alexander Rondo, who is the EU Special Representative in the talks, and he said that both parties should be insisting on the cessation of violence so that these peace talks can have a chance.
And Anne, meanwhile, are people still fleeing the violence? What's happening with the humanitarian crisis on the ground?
Well, it's being described as critical. The UN describes it, especially in Bor and the civilians who are caught up there. The UN was able to access Bor for the first time in a couple of days yesterday. They went to the warehouse, the WFP warehouse there, and got food, you know, taking it to the civilians that have been caught up in this. The UN estimates that about 200,000 people have been displaced from their homes, but humanitarian organizations have only been able to access 100,000 of them. And even so, the places where these people are running to and staying are very overcrowded. There's little food, there's little water, the sanitary facilities are really stretched. And so it's a very dire situation on the ground.
Anne Soy in Juba, and before her, we heard from Emmanuel Igunza in Addis Ababa. South Sudan became independent from Sudan just 2.5 years ago, after 2 decades of conflict in which 1.5 million people are thought to have died. Valentino Deng was born in southern Sudan. He fled from the country in the late 1980s during the Second Sudanese Civil War, when his village was destroyed by militia. He runs the Valentino Achak Deng Foundation, helping to improve access to education for South Sudanese communities.
I am both South Sudanese and an American. I know what it is like to long for freedom and to finally see the birth of a new democracy. I was forced to leave my South Sudanese homeland during the war, but I followed its progress over the years from afar, hoping that my country would emerge as a strong, independent country, one to which I could return and do my part to help assist with the transition into a modern democracy. I believed we were making significant progress on determining how we as South Sudanese would implement our democracy. Then on the 15th of December, I was shocked to hear gunfire as I sat in my hotel in Juba. I thought that was a sound that the capital of our new nation had heard the last of. It became obvious that this was a coup attempt, supported and encouraged by some of the very people who would publicly advocate for democratic rule in South Sudan, but who now resort to violence and stirring ethnic tensions to gain a political advantage. This is not the democracy I or most of my fellow South Sudanese imagined. We are not a country looking for an excuse to break into a civil war along tribal lines. The perpetrators of the political turmoil are not Dinka or Nuer, nor any other ethnic people who make up South Sudan. They are simply people who want power. I strongly believe that our new freedom obligates us all to exhaust all legitimate processes of conflict resolution, the ones that democracy embodies. A political opposition that fuels ethnic conflict is not an opposition that espouses democracy, and it does not represent the best interests of the South Sudanese people. I am bitterly disappointed that apart from the effort of the Intergovernmental Authority on Development, the international community has not more openly condemned the coup attempt and supported the effort of our duly elected president to bring order to the country. We South Sudanese know what it is like to be deprived of freedom, to struggle for our liberty, and we want to live peacefully among ourselves and our neighbors. We may still need assistance from outside from time to time in order to fully attain our goals. I sincerely hope that the international community would do more to support our efforts to maintain our rightfully chosen government.
Valentino Achak Deng, who runs an education foundation for South Sudan. You're listening to Global News, the best stories, interviews and on-the-spot reporting from the BBC World Service. And if you want to comment on this podcast or the topics covered in it, you can send us an email. The address is globalpodcast@bbc.co.uk. And you can also post a message on the BBC World Service Facebook page. That's facebook.com/BBC World Service. The northeast of the US and Canada remain blanketed in snow. It's reported that the bitterly cold weather has killed 16 people. Snowfalls of about half a metre were recorded in several places, and temperatures are set to remain extremely low on Saturday. Ray Furlong reports.
Residents of Philadelphia were digging out after heavy snowfall that grounded flights, closed schools and government offices, and caused multiple deaths. The region is still in the grip of bone-chillingly low temperatures, and many people didn't make it into work. One person who did was Cara Hyde.
I figured I'd go in, especially because I left my laptop at work. I didn't bring it home with me last night. I usually walk to work. It's about a 15 or 20-minute walk, but today it's a little slower. Some sidewalks are shoveled, others aren't. But it's a pretty walk through historic area of Philadelphia, so I don't mind it.
With the wind chill, the temperature dropped as low as minus 38 Celsius in Quebec City, the lowest recorded in 21 years in the Canadian city. Authorities there warned people to stay indoors for their own safety. There was a similar warning in New York from the freshly minted mayor, Joe de Blasio.
I want to say to my fellow New Yorkers, if you want safe, clear streets, stay home. It's very slick out there. If you do not need to travel today, please stay home.
The snap of bad weather has led to more than 4,000 flights being cancelled since Wednesday. But many services have now resumed. The arrivals board at New York's JFK Airport showed delays and cancellations on Saturday morning, but flights were getting through. Boston's Logan International Airport resumed services Friday, although the governor of Massachusetts warned locals of dangerously low temperatures on Saturday. In Washington, these European tourists were just looking forward to getting home.
Our flight is tonight, but it's delayed, so we will stay at the airport and we will wait for the good weather to come back to France.
Washington here is very cold. It seems like in Switzerland. It seems the weather's like in Switzerland, but the wind is very cold here.
The weather in the northeast is expected to get milder on Sunday, but the National Weather Service said that right on the heels of this storm, a powerful blast will bring blizzards and extreme cold to the northern plains and the Midwest this weekend. It said what it called significant snow would fall on an area stretching east to the Great Lakes.
Brave Furlong reporting. The British film 12 Years a Slave is being hotly tipped for award success in the next few weeks. Its director, Steve McQueen, could end up being the first person to win an Oscar, as well as the British Contemporary Art Award, the Turner Prize, which he got back in 1999. The film is based on a true story, the life of Solomon Northup, a middle-class black musician born free in New York State, but then kidnapped and sold into slavery in the American South in 1841. Our arts editor, Will Gompertz, has been speaking to Steve McQueen about the story.
I've always wanted to tell a story about slavery, but I didn't know what or how. And I came up with an idea of a free man, African-American, who had been dragged into slavery because kidnapping was quite prolific.
Well, boy, how you feel now?
My name is Solomon Northup. I'm a free man. A resident of Saratoga, New York, the residence of my wife and children who are equally free. I got stuck in the development of the story after that. I didn't have anything. And my wife said to me, why don't you look into historical first-hand accounts of slavery? And she found this book called 12 Years a Slave. And as soon as I had it in my hand, I opened the book. Every turn of the page was a revelation.
You ain't a free man. You're nothing but a Georgia runaway.
I mean, you think you have an idea what slavery is, but often you don't. And when I shut the book, closed the book when I finished it, I felt quite upset and angry with myself. So why didn't I know this book? But then I realized no one I knew this book. And that's when I made it my passion to make this book into a film. Slavery lasted 400 years. I mean, movies made about slavery are there. I think there's more movies made about Spartacus than there is about slavery.
Why have so few movies about it?
I could only think because of the shame, because of that horrendous, violent, disgusting past. And understandably so, people would be ashamed of it. And therefore, people maybe want to sweep under the carpet.
It's all wrong, Mr. Epps.
They ain't hired help. They're my property.
You say that with pride.
I say it as fact.
If this conversation concerns what is factual and what is not, then it must be said that there is no justice nor righteousness in this slavery.
I bought them. I paid for them.
Brad Pitt, I think it was Brad Pitt, who said, who was in the film and also, I think, helped finance the film, mm-hmm. said it took an Englishman to tell this story.
I'm Englishman, for sure, but I'm part of that narrative. I'm part of that diaspora. I mean, you know, my parents came from the West Indies. And the only difference between myself and African-American is that their boat went right and my boat went left. Right. My mother and father were on that boat, and me and my sister were on the other boat. It's slightly more complex than sort of nationality. It was a world, global industry. Slavery.
You will accept a note.
Please, of course, sir, from you, Mr. Do not Boy. Divide my family. Do not take me unless you take my children.
Liza, quiet!
You will have the most faithful slave in me, the most faithful slave that's ever lived, but I beg that
your
you
prize
do not
for
separate
the boy.
Us.
The boy.
Please.
Stop it. I will give you something to cry about. Please. Randolph, come forward. Come. Now, you see how fit this boy is.
Mm-hmm. Oddly, in the last 24 months, we've seen quite a lot of movies tackling this. Butler, obviously, and Django Unchained last year as well. Why do you think suddenly there's this engagement with a subject which has been hitherto broadly ignored?
No one can underestimate the sort of influence of President Barack Obama. People possibly felt that they had the authority or they had the possibility of making that kind of story. And, of course, maybe financiers thought, yes, we could make a buck out of this now.
When you're directing, are you asking your actors to act or to a certain extent react?
I don't want to work with actors, I want to work with artists. So it's not a case of people just turning up to set and sort of, oh, well, where's my lines? And, okay, stand there and action, turn over. No, I want to know who they are. Mm. And they, obviously they want to know who I am. So therefore they understand that you know, when I ask them to do something, I'm with them hand in hand. So we could go a bit further than possibly they would think of. You want to get lost within your performance, lost within what you do. And that hopefully we record it, so therefore when we look at it, you know, it actually kind of can actually levitate. Something happens within the performance, which is true.
Strip your clothes. Strip. Oh, well, not.
Oh. You will not live to see another day.
And here you go. Into the award season, looking pretty good.
Yeah.
Are you amused by all that or bemused?
You know, it's an honour, really. But, you know, I think we've won already because we made the film that we wanted to make.
I think it was an article, and I think it was in Variety, which said that some of the people who have to watch this as part of their Oscar voting duties are refusing to do so because they think it's too brutal.
Either they want to be within the conversation or they don't want to be in the conversation. It's their choice. Either you close your eyes to a history, we open your eyes to a history. I mean, you know, be involved in the conversation, involved in a situation where there's some kind of reflection or not.
Move along, huh? Come on, Edward! Drive him! Get that gun! Move along, huh?
Will Gompert speaking to the film director, Steve McQueen. The musician Bob Dylan said they started it all, and with their close harmonies and songs about innocent teen life in 1950s America, the Everly Brothers transformed pop music. They also paved the way for the likes of the Beatles and the Beach Boys. Now Phil Everly, one half of the act, has died aged 74 of a smoking-related illness, according to his wife Patty. His friend of 55 years, the guitarist Duane Eddy, said they would reminisce and write songs together. He said Phil's death was a terrible loss.
He's just a part of my life. I can't get my mind around the fact that he's not going to, that I'm not going to talk to him again, or that I'm not going to see him again. Or give him a big hug, or talk about the things we talked about. We talked about, oh, I don't know, the last 10 years, we just get together and talk about the funny things that happened to us in the business.
Peter Bowes in Los Angeles looks back at the Everly Brothers and their influence on pop music. Wake up, little
Susie, wake up. Known for their steel string guitar playing and close harmonies, the Everly Brothers had a unique sound. Hugely popular in the late 1950s and early 60s, the duo defined a musical generation. Accomplished performers and songwriters, they had dozens of hits. Phil and Don set the standard for others to follow. As rock and pop evolved in the 60s, the singing style of the Everly Brothers paved the way for new acts like the Beatles and the Beach Boys. Offstage, there was little harmony between the brothers. They had a stormy relationship. It finally came to a head during a 1973 performance in California when Phil smashed his guitar and stormed off. It was left to Don to confirm that they were breaking up. With their status in the industry unblemished, the Everly Brothers were elected to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in its first year, 1986, and they were later given a Lifetime Achievement Award at the Grammys, a rare accolade for one of music's most enduring acts. Dream, 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 dream. Dream, 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 when I want you in my arms.
Peter Bowes on the legacy of the Everly Brothers. And that's it from us for now, but an updated version of the Global News podcast will be available for you to download on Sunday. I'm Valerie Sanderson. Until next time, goodbye.
This episode of First Cup is sponsored in part by Wishing Stars Native Creations, Marshall Woodworking, Fine Art Today with Maria Sewer, and Mary Kay Cosmetics with Jennifer Jacobs Moorhead. Check out their websites and many more on the Friends page at tinyurl.com/Gunther's House or tinyurl.com/Gunther Mobile. Hi friends, Joe Hefner here. I'll be right back with more First Cup coming up in just a moment.
When severe weather strikes, schools, government buildings, and even Social Security offices may be closed. The place to go to find out about emergency closings is www.socialsecurity.gov/emergency. Social Security's Office Closings and Emergency Information page provides what you need to know about specific offices that are closed due to weather and emergencies, as well as reminders about upcoming federal holidays during which government offices are closed. Select the Get Email Updates link next to the red envelope to receive emails alerting you to emergencies and closings affecting Social Security. Keep in mind that when the weather outside is frightful, using our online services can be so delightful. At www.socialsecurity.gov.
There's a holdup in the Bronx. Brooklyn's broken out in fights. There's a traffic jam in Harlem that's backed up to Jackson Heights. There's a scout troop short of child. Khrushchev's to an Idlewild.
Car 54, where are you?
Welcome back to First Cup. Yours truly, Joe Hefner, here in Studio 20, keeping warm on this very cold Saturday morning here in the Midwest. And we'll take a look at the weather forecast. I'll do that for you in just a few moments, so you don't have to, okay? Speaking of Car 54, and of course has starred the late, great Fred Gwynn, comedian who I thought didn't get enough accolades, I watched a very interesting documentary about him on New Year's Eve before Joe Hefner Live. I didn't talk about it then, but it was a very interesting insight into his life and his childhood and things that made Fred so unique. And of course, he'll be forever recognized, as Herman Munster, the original Herman Munster, and to be the only true Herman Munster. But the man was a brilliant artist, and he also wrote children's books, and with play on words and so forth. So just a little tidbit there to pass along. Well, it's weather time, my friends, and a reminder, you can always get the weather forecast 24/7 by going to the weather link or the weather button at tinyurl.com/Gunther's House. That's good on your PC, Mac, Linux, or tablet computer. On your smartphone at tinyurl.com/Gunther Mobile. Okay? Now, let's take a look at that weather forecast. And take a look at the weather forecast as we start off the weekend together. Ion and a brutal cold greet the United States this weekend. Although I don't think it's going to get a very warm reception from most Americans. Starting off in the northeast, Winter Storm Hercules is now history, and a quiet Saturday is in store for that entire region. It will continue to be extremely cold and windy, though. The morning lows today, below zero over much of New York and New England. Single-digit lows around New York City this morning. Today's highs moderate into the 20s and 30s over most of the region, except colder in northern Maine and New Hampshire. Winter Storm Ion is expected to impact the region late tomorrow, with a band of wintry mix changing to rain and then back to snow from the mid-Atlantic to southeast New England. More significant snow is likely from western Pennsylvania to western New York. Here in the Midwest, blizzard conditions, mainly ground blizzard, for parts of the Dakotas and northwest Minnesota today as the Arctic air begins to blast on through. Wind gusts up to 50 miles per hour over parts of North Dakota and western Minnesota. Snow spreads from the Front Range across Kansas late today. Snow will also fall across parts of Wisconsin and northern Michigan. Windy conditions across the majority of the region. Winter Storm Ion will produce a moderate to significant snowfall from Missouri to Ohio and Michigan tomorrow. St. Louis, Indianapolis, and Detroit are in line for anywhere from 8 inches to a foot of snow accumulation by tomorrow night. An invasion of brutally cold air invades the northern plains and upper Midwest for today. For tomorrow. A dangerous invasion of Arctic air, coldest in nearly 30 years for some areas, moves into the region late this weekend and into early next week. Very low temperatures and wind chills will be the rule of thumb. As a matter of fact, wind chills in the Twin Cities and Chicago by Monday morning could be in the negative 40 degree range. Monday's highs, minus 15 to minus 20 in the Twin Cities and around 10 below in Chicago. So stay indoors on Monday if you can. In the south, not quite as cold and mainly dry conditions across the region, except for a few showers along the southeast coast and into Florida. Showers will spread into eastern Oklahoma and Arkansas today, and then change to snow for northeastern Oklahoma into northern Arkansas tonight. Windy conditions across most of the southern plains in Texas. Rain showers will spread across the entire region tomorrow. Rain to snow tomorrow night across much of Kentucky, Tennessee to northern Alabama and Georgia with icy roadways. Very cold air rushes into the southeast tomorrow night and into Monday. And the cold will last likely until the middle of next week. This will be the coldest air in several years over parts of the southeast, with overnight lows dropping into the single digits and teens for most of the region. Icy roadways for some southeast cities for Monday morning includes Nashville, Huntsville, Chattanooga, Knoxville, and possibly Atlanta. Highs today not as cold, in the 40s and 50s over most of the areas, 60s to near 70 in southern Texas and much of Florida. And finally out west, the story of 2013 continues, with most of the region, especially California, remaining dry for the foreseeable future. Many areas of California and western Oregon set their driest year on record in 2013, and no relief in sight. Light snow is expected across much of Montana and Wyoming today. Light snow will spread across the Colorado Front Range throughout the day, including Denver. Denver will see some accumulating snow, generally 2 to 4 inches by late this afternoon. Windy across much of Colorado and New Mexico. Highs today in the 50s and 60s from northern and central California southeast to southern New Mexico. Warm highs in the 70s in southern California and southern Arizona, staying dry and warm in California into early next week. As far as the Kirksville, Missouri area weather forecast is concerned, a winter weather advisory for snow is in effect for this afternoon through tomorrow. Light snow will gradually begin to develop behind a southeastward moving cold front this afternoon and will increase in intensity as it spreads southeast this evening through early tomorrow. The greatest snowfall accumulations are expected to occur between 6 p.m. this evening and 3 o'clock tomorrow morning. Anticipated snow totals range from around 2 inches across the Kansas City metro area to around 4 inches in central Missouri. A few isolated locations in central Missouri may receive up to 5 inches of total snow accumulation. In addition, very cold temperatures will spread into the area tomorrow, allowing wind chills to drop to 10 to 20 degrees below zero in that range by tomorrow morning. Much colder air and wind chills in the minus 20 to minus 30 degree range are expected Sunday night through at least early Tuesday behind the system. And counties and communities included in this advisory are the following. In Kansas, Miami and Linn counties. In Missouri, it's Leavenworth, Wyandotte, Johnson, and also in Kansas. In Missouri, Adair, Clinton, Caldwell, Livingston, Linn, as well as Macon, Platt, Clay, Ray, Carroll, Sheraton, Randolph, Jackson, Lafayette, Saline, Howard, Cass, Johnson, Pettus, Cooper, Bates, and Henry counties. And includes the communities, the following communities, that is, of Paola, along with Mound City, Leavenworth, Overland Park, as well as Olathe, along with Kirksville, Plattsburgh, Hamilton, Polo, Chillicothe, Brookfield, Macon, La Plata, Parkville, Platt City, Weston, Liberty, Excelsior Springs, Richmond, Carrollton, Salisbury, Keithsville, Moberly, Kansas City, Independence, Lexington, Concordia, Marshall, Fayette, New Franklin, Raymore, Harrisonville, Pleasant Hill, Warrensburg, Sedalia, Boonville, Butler, Rich Hill, and Clinton. And as far as the timing of this storm system, again, winter weather advisory in effect from 3 o'clock this afternoon to 9 o'clock tomorrow morning. Timing, the light snow will develop by mid-afternoon and should begin to taper off by early to mid-morning tomorrow. The highest snowfall accumulations are expected between 6 this evening and 3 o'clock tomorrow morning. Snow accumulations anywhere from 2 to 4 inches with isolated higher amounts possible in central Missouri. As far as impact is concerned, snow will reduce visibilities and cause roads to be slick and other exposed surfaces to become snow-packed. Breezy northerly winds will also result in minor blowing and drifting of snow. Temperatures on the frigid side will spread into the area late tonight and to tomorrow, and will combine with the northerly winds to create wind chills as low as 10 to 20 degrees below zero by tomorrow morning. Much colder wind chills in the minus 20 to minus 30 degree range are expected behind the system tomorrow night, lasting into Tuesday. And a winter weather advisory means that periods of snow, sleet, or freezing rain will cause travel difficulties, so be prepared for slippery roads and limited visibilities and use extra caution when driving. As far as the forecast is concerned, snow likely today, mainly after 3 o'clock this afternoon. Otherwise, cloudy skies, temperatures falling to around 24 degrees by 5 this evening. West to southwesterly winds at 10 to 15 miles an hour. Shifting to the north in the afternoon, wind highs, weather winds gusting as high as 20 miles per hour. Chance of precipitation at this point is at 70%. Total daytime snow accumulations of less than an inch is possible. For tonight, snow continuing, ending by 4 o'clock tomorrow morning. Wind chill values of minus 10 to 0. North winds at 15 to 20 miles an hour, with wind gusts up to 20 to 25 miles an hour. Chance of precipitation tonight at 90%. New snow accumulations of 1 to 3 inches possible. And then for tomorrow, cloudy skies. Snow ending by 9 o'clock tomorrow morning. Mostly cloudy, but very cold. Highs near 7 above. Wind chill values of minus 12 to minus 18. Blustery with north to northwesterly winds at 15 to 20 miles an hour. Wind gust up to about 25 to 30 miles per hour. And then scattered flurries for tomorrow night. Otherwise, mostly cloudy skies. Lows of minus 12. Minus 12 for lows tomorrow night. Wind chill values between minus 23 and minus 33. Northwesterly winds at about 15 to 20 miles an hour. Wind gust up to 25 miles an hour. For Monday, partly sunny skies, continued cold temperatures, high of minus 4. West to northwesterly winds at 15 to 20 miles an hour. Wind gust up to about 25 miles an hour. Partly cloudy skies for Monday night, low of minus 10. And then sunny skies on Tuesday, a little bit warmer. Highs at least above freeze, or rather above zero. Highs near 13, lows of 9 above. And then for Wednesday, cloudy skies with a 30% chance of snow. Highs in the mid-20s, lows in the upper teens to lower 20s. More of the same for Thursday under mostly cloudy skies. Highs in the mid to upper 20s, lows in the upper teens. And then cloudy skies on Friday with a 20% chance of rain and snow. Otherwise mostly cloudy and highs in the low to mid-30s. At last check across the Show Me State, cloudy skies and 37 degrees at KCI Airport, 38 and cloudy in downtown Kansas City, cloudy 35 degrees at St. Joe, 30 and cloudy in Maryville, 37 mostly sunny at Warrensburg, same for Whiteman Air Force Base, cloudy 31 degrees in Kirksville, Moberly checking in with partly sunny skies and 36 degrees this morning. 36 at St. Louis, 36 at the state capitol, 34 mostly sunny in Columbia, 35 at Springfield, and Branson checking in with cloudy skies, 37 degrees, 33 degrees at West Plains. Locally, winds are out of the southwest at about 10 miles per hour, relative humidity at 61%, barometric pressure rising currently at 29.87 inches of mercury, wind chill index reading of 23 degrees. Regionally, cloudy and 35 degrees at Topeka, 38 at Manhattan, 35 in Emporia, 40 in Chanute, and 40 in cloudy in Wichita. Cloudy, 18 degrees in Omaha. Cloudy and 20 in Lincoln, 31 in cloudy at Falls City. Cloudy, 34 degrees at Lamoni, and 23 degrees with light flurries in Des Moines. That, my friends, is a look at the weather forecast for this Saturday morning. And a couple of other reminders with the major outbreak of cold air for tomorrow, lasting into Tuesday morning. Here are a few other reminders. High temperatures on Sunday, of course, will be bitterly cold. And a few precautionary steps, a few things to keep in mind. Never venture outdoors without wearing gloves, a hat, and several layers of clothing. Windchill values, again, will be very cold for Sunday night, lasting into Tuesday morning. Run water at a trickle and keep cabinet doors open to prevent pipes from freezing. Never use a stove or oven to heat your home, or use an open flame to melt frozen pipes. Many house fires result from these practices. Also, be sure to check the tire pressure in your car battery before venturing out. Be sure your car has a winter safety kit that includes a blanket, warm clothes, and gloves in case your car breaks down or becomes stranded. And take extra steps to keep your pets warm and know their limits to the cold. Whimpering, shivering, or slowing down could be signs of hypothermia. And that, my friends, is the weather forecast and some safety tips on this bitterly cold weekend weather forecast. Not a great way to start off 2014. But I guarantee you in about 3 or 4 months, we'll be looking back on this as the winter of 2014, won't we? Might not even remember it. But that's neither here nor there. Well, still to come, I'll have celebrity birthdays for you in a few minutes, as well as today in history, plus a whole lot more, including the song of the day, going out to the late, great Phil Everly. Right now, though, we're going to take a quick break, and when I come back, I have for you on this program, what do I have on this program for you? Let's see here. Composer's Datebook, as well as All Things Considered, and Garrison Keillor with Writer's Almanac is coming up next. So stick around, my friends. From Studio 20, I'm Joe Hafner, and this is your First Cup.
If you are disabled and you're no longer able to work, you should learn about the Social Security Disability Insurance Program. If you qualify, you can receive a monthly disability benefit from Social Security for as long as your disability keeps you from working. The amount of your benefit is based on your average lifetime earnings. After a period of time, you may also qualify for medical coverage. If you have a disability that makes you unable to work, visit www.socialsecurity.gov/disability.
McGruff here.
The crime doc?
Yep.
I think I'm gonna need your help. I've got an internet bully.
Okay, well, what you do is...
Maybe you could put a virus on her computer. Or a tracking device. Or a bug.
You don't have to do that, are you?
Or maybe we could get an attack dog. You ever see those attack dogs that can, like, rip a person's arm off? Seriously. Or like a SWAT team. A cyber SWAT team or something. Or like an army. Did you ever see that zombie army movie? We should get a zombie army.
Wait. All you need to do to stop an internet bully is delete their messages and never forward them on.
So, no zombies?
No zombies.
Bummer.
Delete cyberbullying. Don't write it, don't forward it. For more information, visit ncpc.org. A message from the U.S. Department of Justice, Crime Prevention Coalition of America, National Crime Prevention Council, and the Ad Council.
This episode of First Cup is sponsored in part by Wishing Stars Native Creations, Marshall Woodworking, Fine Art Today with Maria Sewer, and Mary Kay Cosmetics with Jennifer Jacobs-Moorhead. Check out their websites and many more on the Friends page at tinyurl.com/Gunther's House or tinyurl.com/Gunther Mobile.
And here is the Writer's Almanac for Saturday. It's the 4th of January, 2014. It was on this day 10 years ago, 2004, NASA's Spirit rover landed successfully on Mars. Its twin spacecraft, Opportunity, landed on the other side of Mars 3 weeks later, a mission that set out to analyze rock and soil samples, look for evidence of water, determine whether the environment on Mars was conducive to life. Spirit was expected to operate for only 90 days, but it sent Data back to Earth for more than 6 years. It's the birthday of Sir Isaac Newton, Woolsthorpe, England, 1643, born prematurely, so small he could fit into a quart pot. Went off to Cambridge, and when it was shut down during a plague, he went home and he studied mathematics and physics on his own. And it was during that time he developed his theories of gravity and optics. At the age of 43, published his Principia, which overturned nearly everything that science had believed about the universe up to that point. It's the birthday of Jakob Grimm, the elder of the brothers Grimm, born in Hanau, Germany, 1785. He and his brother volunteered to help some friends gather folk tales for a research project. And they did such a great job that they published the stories in book form, which filled several volumes and which included Snow White and Sleeping Beauty, Rumpelstiltskin, and Rapunzel. The original versions, so violent and grotesque, the stories were significantly toned down so as not to frighten children. It's the birthday of Louis Braille, born in Couvray, France, 1809, blinded at the age of 3 by an accident in his father's harness shop, and he set out to adapt an idea that was used in the French army to send messages that could be read in the dark, in which each letter would be represented by a different arrangement of 6 raised dots, packed close enough so that each letter could be read by a single fingertip. He perfected this by the time he was 15 years old. And it's the birthday of Max Eastman, born in Canandaigua, New York, 1883, got a Ph.D. in philosophy from Columbia, moved to Greenwich Village. He was an outspoken critic of the United States' involvement in World War I, arrested twice for sedition, but later became more critical of Marxism, became a free market capitalist, called himself a radical conservative, and became a columnist for the National Review. Also published translations of Pushkin and wrote 5 volumes of poetry. Here's a poem for today by Linda Paston, In This Season of Waiting. Under certain conditions, when the moon in the western sky seems frozen there, for instance, even as the sun is rising in the east, so that soon 2 sides of the coin will be facing each other, or when the snow, which is a stranger here, fills our trees with its cold flowers, when the single blue jay at the feeder is so still it could be enameled there. Then the earth becomes an emblem for whatever we believe. Linda Paston's poem, In the Season of Waiting, from her collection Heroes in Disguise, published by W.W. Norton, used by permission here on the Writer's Almanac, supported by the Poetry Foundation, publisher of Poetry Magazine. Now available in a digital subscription for iPad and iPhone. Subscriptions at poetryfoundation.org/digitalmag. Engineered by Noah Smith, produced by Joy Biles. Be well, do good work, and keep in touch.
This is the Composer's Datebook for January 4th. I'm John Zeck. Resolved. New York is the cultural capital of the United States. That's a subject a lot of people would debate, but few would contest New York's important role in so much of our country's musical history. In 1992, to celebrate its 150th anniversary, the New York Philharmonic commissioned many new works by leading composers, and they spread out their celebratory premieres over several years. On today's date in 1996, Leonard Slatkin conducted one of these, an orchestral tribute to New York written by a native son, a work by Richard Daniel Poor titled Toward the Splendid City. While intended as a sonic portrait of his hometown, Daniel Poor's piece was actually written entirely outside of the city. As he himself explains it, Toward the Splendid City is one of the very few works I've written completely away from New York. Work on the piece began in Seattle and was completed in Taos, New Mexico, and to an extent expresses the nostalgia I felt for the city. It became my sonic postcard of the town. One passage, a sound painting with string harmonics, celesta, harp, vibes, and bells, was inspired by my memory of floating about New York at night on a plane and seeing the lights of the city in the mist. For more information on Richard Daniel Poor and his music, check our website at composersdatebook.org. Composer's Datebook is a production of APM, American Public Media, and the American Composers Forum, reminding you that all music was once new.
Experts have not cornered the market on good ideas. The innovative engineering program in Texas has been proving college undergraduates can tackle and solve vexing challenges in providing health care in developing countries. NPR's Joe Palca has been exploring how inventions come to be as part of his new beat, Joe's Big Idea. Today, he introduces us to two engineers who are tapping the potential of bright young minds to change the world.
Rural hospitals in the developing world have lots of problems. Some are huge: lack of electricity, lack of staff, lack of supplies. But some problems are much smaller and can be overcome with a bit of ingenuity.
We want to teach our students that they can solve these problems.
Maria Oden is an engineering professor at Rice University in Houston. She runs a program designed to get students to first learn about the problems of rural hospitals and then find solutions.
These are not going to be MRI machines or CT machines.
Rebecca Richards-Cordham is the chair of bioengineering at Rice and Oden's partner in this project.
These are going to be simple technologies that you could develop in the course of a semester or the course of a year.
Maybe a simple system to measure drug dosage or a way to deliver the right amount of IV fluids. The students have to develop a prototype, but Maria Oden says some of these students will take their invention even further.
Go into the field, test it, get feedback, return to Rice, redesign most of the time. The first design doesn't work very well, and so they redesign it until they get to a point where it's a product that can be deployed. That's the ultimate goal for sure.
Oden says once a team of undergraduates sinks its teeth into a project, it's hard to let go.
We have teams who may have been in a class 4 semesters ago, and they are still working on this project, not because they're getting credit, not because they're in a course, but because they want to solve this problem.
One of the most successful projects has been something called a bubble CPAP. It helps premature infants breathe by pushing a stream of air into their lungs. Richards-Cordham says a team of Rice students found some clever ways to make a bubble CPAP that was affordable.
One of the wonderful things about working with 18-year-olds is that they're so creative. They don't have fixed ideas about what might not work. And so you get really crazy ideas. Like inside our bubble CPAP machine, there's aquarium pumps.
Aquarium pumps? Well, why not? I mean, they're cheap and they worked. The students developed their inventions in something called the Oshman Engineering Design Kitchen on the Rice campus. I recently went there for a visit, and Maria Oden showed me some of the prototypes their students had made.
This right here is the original CPAP device.
It looks like in one of the boxes. Yeah, exactly.
It's in a plastic shoebox from Target.
And some hoses coming out with some tubing and a fish tank pump.
Two fish tank pumps.
In case one breaks or to keep them going.
No, you need two to get enough flow.
Oden says they've tested their bubble CPAP in rural hospitals in Malawi, and now they're starting to deploy them at hospitals around that country. The device is snazzied up to look more professional, but basically it's the same as the prototype, aquarium pumps and all. Richards-Cordham says it's a long slog to go from design to product to actually seeing something work, but it's worth it.
It's sort of magic when you see it come together. It's the best part of our job.
What was the most magical moment that you've had in the last year?
Oh, that's easy.
Richards-Cordham and Oden went to Malawi a while back with one of the students who had worked on the bubble CPAP design project. They visited one of the rural hospitals where they tested the bubble CPAP device.
And we went into the maternity ward, and a nurse came up to us.
The nurse said, "We used the bubble CPAP on my baby, and it saved his life."
She was able to go get her baby so that we could meet the baby, and the student was able to look and see a life that she had affected. And so for me, it was, you know, it just sort of sent chills all the way down my entire spine, because I realized that while we're teaching students and we want them to leave here believing they can make a difference, this was the picture of a true difference being made.
Odin and Richards Cordom are hoping that once students learn how wonderful it feels to make a difference in the world, they'll be hooked. And at least some of those students will devote their professional lives to doing that. Joe Palca, NPR News.
This episode of First Cup is sponsored in part by Wishing Stars Native Creations, Marshall Woodworking, Fine Art Today with Maria Suhr, and Mary Kay Cosmetics with Jennifer Jacobs Moorhead. Check out their websites and many more on the Friends page at tinyurl.com/Gunther's House or tinyurl.com/Gunther Mobile. Just reliving my childhood, folks. Don't mind me. I'm playing a little bit of Asteroids here. And, that was close. Anyway, let's see. Normally, I was going to... what I was planning on playing next was the CBS Weekend News Wrap-Up. I'm going to put that off until tomorrow because there's not going to be enough time to do that along with everything else that I need to get in. I forgot the segment was so long. And, that's what she said! Anyway... so I'm going to put that off until tomorrow's show and run it then. But I still have the Song of the Day coming up in a few minutes, as well as Today in History. But right now, though, what do you say we take care of some celebrity birthdays? So let me make sure I have my list here. And, you know, I could have done that while the news was on, but it's much more fun when you're flying by the seat of your pants and, you know how that goes. Okay, so let me pull up the browser, wait for the information to load, and let's see here, Today in History, blah, 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 is it on there? Okay, we got that, all right, what did I do with the celebrity birthdays? Yeah, okay, just bear with me for just a moment, I forgot to load celebrity birthdays. I got Today in History taken care of, and I actually remembered to load it ahead of time, but for whatever reason, I don't have celebrity birthdays here. Let's try that one. Famous birthdays, okay. We don't want it for the third. How do you get to the fourth without punching it in on the address bar? Let's see. Who designed the site? It's a poorly designed website. Okay, let's do it by January. Today is the 4th, correct? That is correct. And, here we are. See all. Alright. January 4th. So we'll push that one. And, let's see, is that right? No, that was yesterday. Did I tap the wrong one? Go back. Okay. January 4th. See all. Why does it keep bringing up the 3rd? Okay, the faces are different. Alright, now it's time for celebrity birthdays. And without further delay, here's the music for that.
Damn it, Jim. What the hell is the matter?
Damn it, Jim. I can't hear you. Let's try that again. Hold on. Alright, press the stop. Volume up. I'll turn my microphone off and I'll hit play again.
Damn it, Jim, what the hell is the matter with you? Other people have birthdays. Why are we treating yours like a funeral?
Bones, that ought to be lectured.
Ooh, yeah. Very, very many happy reasons.
And time for a look at celebrity birthdays. But before I do so, if you're celebrating your birthday today, happy birthday. And you share your birthday with these famous people. They include hip-hop producer and performing artist who found success with the singles Beneath Your Beautiful and Earthquake in 2012. Labyrinth is 25. Louis Braille, or is it Louis Braille? Well, he was born on the state in 1809. Inventor of a system of writing for blind people, known as Braille, who was blinded himself as a child. Okay, 1809 to 1852. Greg Sipes, talented voice actor who has brought life to animated characters on Teen Titans, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, and Ben 10. He is 34 today. Erin Cahill, a supporting television actress who had her breakout role as the Pink Ranger in the Power Rangers Time Force. She is 34 today. And we'll see what else here. Don Shula, yeah, coach of the Miami Dolphins. Perfect 14-0 season and Super Bowl championship in 72. Don Shula is 84 today. And two-time heavyweight boxing champion of the world, Floyd Patterson, born in the state in 1935, died in 2006. And country music singer Patti Loveless is 57 today. Of course, her hits You Can Feel Bad and Lonely Too Long are some of her bigger hits. Okay. See if there's anyone else on here that I wanted to read. Oh, Dina Carter. Ooh, yeah. I don't think she's done much lately, has she? She was pretty big for a while in the late 90s. Platinum-selling country artist who released the number one single, Strawberry Wine, We Danced Anyway. She's 48 today. Okay. And today would have been General Tom Thumb's birthday. He was born in the state in 1838, died in 1883. He was a dwarf who performed in P.T. Barnum's circus. Well, that's enough for today in history. Now it's time to go back in time. And Professor Peabody is standing by for today in history. Take it away, Professor.
Hello there, Peabody here. Once again, it is time to take another revealing peek back into history.
What famous date shall I set it to today, Mr. Peabody?
And on this date, January 4th, 1885, is our first stop as we step back in time. On this date in 1885, Dr. William W. Grant of Davenport, Iowa, not too far from here, performed what is thought to be the world's first appendectomy. That was on this date in 1885. And now for more of today in history, here's the Associated Press and their overmodulated, slightly distorted levels.
The main danger to stability is terror.
January 4th, 2006. Israel's Prime Minister Ariel Sharon suffers a significant stroke and lapses into a coma. It happens just months after Sharon ends Israel's 38-year occupation of the Gaza Strip and bolts his own hardline Likud party. Sharon's official powers are transferred to his deputy, Ehud Olmert, who later succeeds him as Prime Minister. 1809. Louis Braille, the inventor of a reading system for the blind, which bears his name to this day, is born in a town near Paris. 1999.
The one thing you'll get from Governor Jesse Ventura, you may not always want to hear it, but you will get honesty.
Former pro wrestler Jesse the Body Ventura vows to be a straight talker after he's sworn in as the governor of Minnesota. And 1965. Poet T.S. Eliot, whose work inspired and supplied most of the words for the musical Cats years later, dies in London at age 76. Today in history, January 4th, Sophia Manos, The Associated Press.
And it's time now for the Song of the Day, my friends, my favorite portion of First Cup. And today's song of the day is a last-minute fill-in, no pun intended. Oh, that was bad. I'm sorry. Well, anyway, I didn't mean that. The song that I've chosen is a ballad written by Albert Hammond and Mike Hazelwood, initially recorded by Albert Hammond on his 1972 album, It Never Rains in Southern California. The tune is called The Air That I Breathe. The song was a major hit for the Hollies in early 1974, reaching number 2 in the UK. In the summer of 74, the song reached number 6 in the United States on the Billboard Hot 100 chart and number 3 on the Adult Contemporary chart. In Canada, the song peaked at number 5 on the RPM magazine charts. Audio engineering for The Air That I Breathe was done by Alan Parsons. Well, in the 1990s, Radiohead recycled the chord progression on their song Creep, and group co-credited the track to Albert Hammond and Michael Hazelwood after getting sued. Cover versions of the song includes Olivia Newton-John, who released her version on the 1975 album Have You Ever Been in Mellow. Hank Williams Jr. covered the song on his 1983 album Man of Steel. And let's see what else we have for you. Some others includes The Mavericks covering their song on their self-titled 2003 album. Their version peaked at number 59 on the Billboard Hot Country charts in that year. But the version I've chosen for you, of course, is in honor of the passing of Phil Everly. And he was the first credited with covering the song, and he did so for his 1973 album, Star Spangled Springer. Okay? And in honor of Phil Everly, it's time for today's Song of the Day, The Air That I Breathe.
If I could make a wish, I think I'd pass. Can't think of anything I need. No cigarettes, no sleep, no light. No sound, nothing to eat, no books to read. Making love with you has left me peaceful, warm and tired. What more could I ask? There's nothing left to be desired. Peace came upon me and it leaves me weak. So sleep, silent angel, go to sleep. Sometimes all I need is the air that I breathe and to love you. All I need is the air that I breathe, yes, to love you. All I need is the air that I
and it leaves me weak. Sleep, silent angel, go to
sleep. The Now Late Phil Everly, and today's song of the day, The Air That I Breathe. Beautiful rendition. Actually, I like that one more than I like the Hollies version. Took a little getting used to, though, but I do like that version a whole lot more. It's time now to find out what's coming up on television excuse me, later on today and into tonight as we head into the weekend and wait for the information to load on my old computer. So bear with me. Dealing with an antiquated processor and oh, good. The antivirus program decided to kick on. So that's going to bog the system down even more. Alright. And let's see. What's on TV for tonight? For today. Alright. And there's the page. Alright, that's good to know. That was yesterday's. I need today's. Okay, keep going. Alright. Here's what's on television. All times, by the way, are Eastern, so please, I implore you, adjust accordingly, or you're going to be severely disappointed, okay? NCAA College Bowl Games, BBVA Compass Bowl, Vanderbilt versus Houston from Legion Field in Birmingham, Alabama, this afternoon at 1 o'clock. Also, NFL Wild Card Games, AFC Wild Card Game, Kansas City Chiefs versus the Indianapolis Colts at Indianapolis. That gets underway at 4:35 this afternoon. The Chiefs are going to lose. But you didn't hear that from me. And in the NFC wild card game, New Orleans Saints at Philadelphia Eagles tonight at 8:10 on NBC. And also speaking of NBC, later on tonight, Saturday Night Live repeat, host and musical guest to be determined. That gets underway tonight at 11:29 Eastern on the Nothing But Censors Network, NBC. Okay? Tomorrow, it's National Bird Day. Learn more about that on tomorrow's program, as well as the last legal hanging in the United States occurred on tomorrow's date in such and such year, and I'll have details on that. That's called a teaser. That's what we call that in the business. Okay? All right. Well, that's going to wrap it up for the show for today. I'll be back again tomorrow with another edition of First Cup. Sunday brunch edition coming up at 11:30 Central Standard Time. That's coming up tomorrow with another edition of First Cup. Okay. Send me your comments via email to GunthersHouseOfFriends@gmail.com. That's GunthersHouseOfFriends@gmail.com. Or leave a message on my Skype account at G800-486-8437. That's G800-486-8437. You can also follow me on Twitter at JHafner99, as well as on Gunther's Friends. And so what else? Check out my website, tinyurl.com/Gunther's House. That's good on your PC, Mac, Linux, or tablet computer. Or on your smartphone at tinyurl.com/Gunther Mobile. You can also listen to previous episodes of this show by getting the Stitcher app, the Spreaker app. That's at Stitcher.com or at Spreaker.com. Look up Gunther's House of Friends, or you can get the Stitcher app available on the opening page of my website, as well as on Miro at GetMiro.com. A little program to download there, and that'll help you to organize it, as well as on iTunes and on the Windows Media Store. Okay? And that's going to do it for the show today. I also want to thank my sponsors. I neglect to do that from time to time. I want to thank my sponsors, which includes Wishing Stars Native Creations, Marshall Woodworking, Fine Art Today, and Mary Kay Cosmetics with Jennifer Jacobs Moorhead. Okay, check them out, plus many more sponsors, by going to the Friends page, again at tinyurl.com/Gunther's House or tinyurl.com/Gunther Mobile. And that's going to do it for today. Again, I'll be back tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock, at 11:30 Central Standard Time, for a Sunday brunch edition of First Cup. Okay? All right, so time for me to skedaddle on out of here and get ready for work, because I have another long night ahead of me, but hopefully it will go by as fast. Not nearly as fast as this show, but it, 12 hours can seem like an eternity some nights, especially when you're standing on your feet in a cold room. Okay. Well, with that being said, no one ever said life was going to be easy, my friends. And boy, ain't that the truth. Try and do the right thing. Be kind to one another. After all, if one of us falls out of the boat of life, let's lend a hand and help that person back in. Okay? No sense in fooling around out there and trying to figure out what you're going to do. I'll catch you on the flip-flop, my friends. See you tomorrow. Live long and prosper.
Was produced by Joe Hafner. To hear more of my podcast, check out my website, tinyurl.com/Gunther's House. Gunther, go to the house.